Hey players, I think we're live now. So welcome to Getting Ready for the New Year. This is going to be a Q&A style Josh Speaks Google Hangout. I try to do these every so often. Now, if you just tuned into this video, what I want you to do is if you're watching the recording, hit the thumbs up button because we're going to talk about some really cool stuff. And if you're tuning in live, you can join in either on Google Plus, the Google Plus page, or you can join in the event page or on YouTube and start leaving comments and questions. I'm going to try to make my way through them on the YouTube page as well as the Google Plus page. So this is going to be streaming on both. So if you want to check it out on either, you certainly can. Okay. So the first thing I want to talk to you guys, hit my microphone here. I have a new setup. This is all new. What I'm going to be doing too is linking out every single question in the description of the video. So if you don't want to sit for the full 2 hours or so, and you want to just see what my answers are to specific questions, maybe it's a dating question, maybe it's a question regarding something at school or dealing with something at home, check in the description. I'm going to put timestamps to every question so you can check them out and you can tell me what you can look to see what you want to learn there. Sorry, people are messaging me while I'm doing this and it's really distracting, but I'm going to focus anyway. So there's a few of you guys in here already. Good to see you all. I'm gonna turn on the Q&A here. And let me open up also the YouTube page so I can get an idea of where the questions are coming in from. So let me get that open here. And this is gonna be fun. I think we're gonna have a good time here. The new year starts tomorrow for me. I know for some people it's already on. Let me just mute that audio on the YouTube page there. But you can start asking your questions. Comments are disabled for this video. Why are they disabled? I don't get how this works sometimes. But anyway, for those of you that are on, if you can ask a question, jump in on the Google Plus page, the event page, and start putting your questions in there. I'm going to check on the main page itself and see. So people are already leaving questions in here. I'm going to kind of go through some of them that were left. When I set up the event and stuff, people joined in. So the first question, let's talk about here. So Daryl Jared asked, can you talk about not stressing and having regrets about most things you do? For example, regretting buying a different lunch, not talking to someone. Also, you can talk about making decisions. So I'm gonna get into a little bit of that first. So when we think of regrets and we think of buyer's remorse and, oh, maybe I should have chose this over that, or did I make the best decision? Did I make the right decision? These are the kind of things that we kind of think of on a different, every day, on a daily basis. And for different people, you know, sometimes it's very intense, sometimes it's not as intense. So this idea of making the right decision kind of always weighs over our head. And it can kind of, you know, drag us down and make us feel bad and make us feel like we made the wrong choice in life. But here's my thoughts on that. When it comes to any kind of decision that you make, whether it's a thought out decision or a decision for your gut, it's kind of the choice that is set. It's happened. You put it into play. Now, the previous choices of what you had options to may not exist in that moment anymore. So for example, let's say you wanted to go to the store and buy something and you're choosing between a red shirt and a blue shirt. And you're like, okay, well, which shirt do I like more? So you decide on the red shirt. And you go home, you try it on, and you're like, you know what, that blue shirt looked a lot better. Maybe I should have picked the blue shirt. And so that's a question that can kind of run through your mind. You may say, you know, I made the wrong decision. This was stupid. But at the end of the day, you have the red shirt. You can't go back and you can't be in that moment again to choose the red or the blue shirt. So all you really have is the option to, sorry about that. What is this? Who is someone's bothering me? My mistake. So you have the option now to only go forward. You can't go back and change the time in the past. All you can do is decide, okay, well, do I want to keep this red shirt or do I want to return it for a blue shirt? You know, those are really your options. Your options are how can you progressively move forward? And I think what happens a lot is that we usually regret our previous decisions, but we never really spend too much time thinking about how can we progressively move forward. Generally, that kind of thought process happens way after. Maybe it's after we've already come to terms with our decision. We've already said, you know what? I can't do anything about it. I might as well move forward. So for every person, like I was saying before, it's a different waiting period. Some people are able to quickly jump back and say, oh man, I made a bad decision. let me switch it up, let me do something good now. And some people take days, take months, take a long time to really kind of come to that point where they're okay with what happened and they're kind of, they've accepted it and they're ready to move on. There's nothing wrong with either method. Whether you're a person that can jump in quick or you're someone that takes some time to do it, either way, however you do it is your style. And, you know, you may have people around you that tell you, well, just get over it. Or you may have someone around you that says, like, you just don't understand, you know, just move on. This can happen a lot because what people tend to do is they will kind of push on their way of handling things onto you. So if you're the kind of person that gets really distraught and hurt over how you felt about something, someone else may not take as long and feel like, well, I was able to get over it quickly. Why can't you just get over it? And people don't work like that. So it really is a process to learn others, to learn about others, and to learn, okay, well, you know, how long do they take to kind of recuperate? And are they the kind of person that needs consoling or time to really move on? And I think in helping others and learning others, you learn a little bit about yourself. You begin to learn, okay, what do I need when I feel like I make the wrong decision? So if you ever feel remorseful about something, you know, I want to talk to the girl, I really like her, and oh no, there she goes, she just left, I missed my opportunity, and you feel bad, you feel like you messed up, like, damn it, I should have just did it. You know, you only have the option to go forward. And you have to ask yourself, well, how long do I generally take to move forward? Is it a long process for me, or am I able to quickly get back on my feet? I think the more you encounter kind of these situations where things don't work out or you're trying things out, and sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, the better you'll become equipped with recuperating quicker. So the more that you're more daring, the more that you're challenging. So for example, let's talk about asking a girl, because I think a lot of you guys really run into that issue where it's like, I want to talk to my crush, but she's always with her friends, or I want to talk to my crush and I'm too shy, or she's too shy, or she's a popular girl, or I'm ugly, or whatever you're feeling in the moment. You may come up with a reason not to do it and then feel bad afterwards. So it's only through putting yourself through the process of, you know what, I didn't talk to her, that sucks, but you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna try to talk to other girls. I'm gonna try to talk to other people. I'm gonna get in the habit and get comfortable with talking to people to the point where if someone rejects me or I miss an opportunity, it doesn't matter because I know I'm gonna jump on the next opportunity the second I can. So it's a matter of learning yourself and learning your process and your speed and practicing. Practicing is really how you're gonna be able to kind of move forward and be able to enhance that time. So I kind of gave a little bit of lengthy answer. It's the first question there. I wanted to kind of go a little bit more in depth. I think at some point I want to get into the whole idea of starting this new year and how we could look at this as something really positive. And, you know, a lot of people say, oh, new year, no one changes. But I want to put forward a quick plan on how you can make a progressive change. And Alex Logue, I see your question there. What's the best way to be more spiritually happy? I'm going to get to that in a second. What I want to let you guys know is that in a little bit I'm going to talk to you about a new project that I'm working on with one of my friends over on Patreon. He's a patron of the channel, The Josh Speaks. If you guys are interested in joining and helping to support the channel, you can do so over on patreon.com/TheJoshSpeaks. I'm gonna put that in the description as well. Basically, I offer different perks. So for $1 or $3 or $6, $9, whatever you feel you want to give, even if you don't want to give money, you can just support the channel. Just to support the channel, there's different perks. So I believe, I forgot what I said, but what I want to start doing is rolling out so the Patreon patrons or Patreons of the channel can be involved in this new project that I'm working on. So I want to talk a little bit about that in a bit, but I want to answer the next question, which is going to be Alex Logue. So Alex says, what's the best way to be more spiritually happy? Okay, so let's select it. All right, so from my perspective, we need to really look at what spirituality means. To some, spirituality means being religious or being part of a group of people who worship, being part of a church group or a synagogue or a mosque. To some people, being religious or being spiritual could mean being one with the world, one with the earth, one with nature. To some, spiritual could mean being in tune with yourself. So there's many different ideas of what spirituality means. Sorry, hold on a second. Someone keeps bothering me on Google chat, and I need to leave me alone because the message thing keeps popping up. So whoever you are, just leave me alone. I keep hearing the sound. It's like, stop bothering me. Anyway, so back to the question on spirituality. So for me personally, I view spirituality as being kind of connected with others and other living beings around you. So I can be spiritual through feeling a connection with my neighbor, feeling a connection with my coworkers, with my friends, with my family, with my dogs, with anyone I encounter, any kind of living being that kind of breathes this energy of life. And there's a spiritual connection because we're all alive and we're all here and we're all, you know, lucky to be able to live and move forward and to progress in life. So the best way to be more spiritually happy, I think, comes down to understanding yourself. And I keep saying that, but I'll explain what I mean here. So when I say understanding yourself in terms of spirituality, I mean understanding how you kind of fit into the whole cogwheel of what being spiritual is. So if you're spiritual in the sense that I kind of outlined, where it's spiritual simply means being connected with others, understanding how you're connected with others, how you can influence other people's lives, how you can positively kind of influence them and affect them and make them happy and make them feel motivated to do things. So I think the best way to be spiritually happy is to understand how you affect others and understand how you can bring positive and progressive changes in their lives. You know, we all are connected to each other in some way. You know, you think about just your Facebook friends alone. You know, you post a status and people like it and they comment and they share it or whatever it is. So you're already affecting people's lives day to day. So you have to ask yourself, well, is what I'm putting out into the world something that's positive? Am I inspiring others? Am I making them feel happy and lucky to be alive as well? And it's in helping others, it's in knowing that you're putting good into the world that you'll feel that good come back. You know, a lot of people say, oh, well, I do a lot of good things, but you know, no one does good for me. And I think you're approaching it then the wrong way. The best way to do it is to just look at your own values. You know, do you enjoy being happy? Do you enjoy being at peace? Do you enjoy these things? And if you do enjoy them, then I feel like the best thing you can do to be spiritually happy is to kind of put that back into the world and to help others become happy as well. You know, it's this kind of growth that we see in our lives that kind of allow people to be prosperous and be happy and kind of everyone grows spiritually. So if you practice Christianity, you practice a different kind of religion or whatever it may be, look to those and say, well, what positive qualities and positive attributes can I take from these teachings? And how can I put that forward into the world? So I think that's how you can develop a sense of spiritual happiness. So, okay, so there's a bunch of questions coming in here. Matthew or Amram? No, dude, Matthew, it was not you. That was messaging me. It was one of my friends. He just kept messaging me on GChat, and it was like, hey. So here, this guy says it. But Matthew, don't worry, it was not you. Don't feel bad. Hey, Minecraft Land Creeper, I'm happy that I helped you. For anyone new that's tuning in, the 48 viewers right now, I'm so happy that you guys are here. We're gonna be talking about getting ready for the new year. Sorry about that. We're going to be talking about getting ready for the new year and how you can kind of look at the new year as a springboard to kind of plan the next 12 months of your life to be positive and be progressive and happy. So I keep mentioning those words, and I want to kind of explain to you guys what I'm planning on doing with the Josh Speaks in 2016 as well. I really want to grow this channel, and I really want your guys' help. So I'm going to jump to the next question, and then I'll explain it. So Blaster6009 says, Josh, if your girlfriend keeps fighting with you because she can't move on, how do you get her to move on and stop creating fights with you? I'm sorry, if your ex-girlfriend. So pretty much your ex-girlfriend keeps fighting and she can't move on. So how do you get her to stop fighting and just kind of like let you be? So usually when someone's considered an ex, it's usually because things didn't work out and maybe you guys didn't get along, maybe you had a big falling out or a fight, maybe you just didn't connect anymore. You decided it's best to move on. So in this case, it sounds like she can't move on and she keeps fighting, and there may still be something there that she feels is unresolved. Now, if you feel like your ex-girlfriend or someone that was in your life and you kind of want them to leave is constantly jumping in, constantly messaging you or leaving comments or interfering with your connections with other people, I think the best thing to do in those situations is not to try to avoid them or ignore them, but to talk to them directly. You know, if talking to them directly doesn't work, then you have no choice but to ignore them. You tried everything you can. But when I say talk to them directly, what I simply mean is to sit down and say, hey, we need to talk about what's going on here. I feel like maybe we ended things, but it wasn't clear where we stood. You know, I want you to go on and I want you to be happy. And I don't, you know, I don't want to drag you down. I don't want to create any negativity in your life. So, you know, could we just move on? Sometimes you may have that conversation and the person still has this kind of pent up anger and aggression and rage or unfulfillment. Like, no, but you need to know why you're wrong. You need to know what you did. Sometimes they need to vent and get it off their chest. Now that's up to you if you want to sit and say, you know what, I'll let them vent, let them get it off, and then let them be on their way. It's a lot of work and it's very hard to do that sometimes because it may hurt you to hear those things, but sometimes if they just get it off their chest, they'll move on. If they're interfering with another relationship you may have, it may be because of jealousy. Maybe they feel like you broke up with them and you know, you're trying to move on and they're not ready to move on, so they don't want someone else interfering. It could be a number of factors. The best thing to do is to really sit down and try to talk to them, try to be open with them and say, hey, listen, I want us to be okay and we weren't right for each other and I don't want a fight. I don't want any problems. I want us to kind of move on and, excuse me, and go about our ways peacefully. So try that approach first. I think a calm approach is always the best approach initially. If it doesn't work and there's a lot of rage there and you're not getting through to them, then the best thing you could do is distance yourself, because jumping into the rage with them is only going to involve them more. It's only going to make them feel like, oh, I got a reaction. Let me try again. Let me try more. And that's the last thing you want. You don't want to encourage bad behavior. So I hope that answers your question. So let's look at Lewis. Lewis Young says, hey, Josh, I like to eat bananas and I want to share my bananas with my crush. You think bananas are a fair gift? Okay. When we talk about gifts, if you're interested in learning a little bit more about my idea of gifts, I did a video called four Christmas gift ideas you can get for your girlfriend. I think that was the name of the title. I'll put the link in the description. Sorry about that. I've done a lot of videos, but let's say bananas are something that you want to give your girlfriend, a fruit or something kind of very simple, you know, like, I bought a chocolate, let me share it with her. Or I bought a flower, let me share it with her. Gifts are something that are your personal way of showing that person you care about them. So the best thing you can do is try to really take time to think about what's something that they would like and do your best to really put that forward and say, hey, you know what, that's something they like. Let me try to get it for them. Let me maybe make them happy. Now, if we're talking about giving a gift to your crush, that's a little different, because if it's someone like your girlfriend or your boyfriend, you already have this kind of built relationship with each other. But if someone like your crush, there's a lot of situations that could occur. Sometimes your crush doesn't know who you are. Sometimes your crush is someone that you're just talking to. Sometimes your crush views you as just a friend, and a gift might just scare them off. So what I would recommend is not getting a gift, even if it's bananas, for your crush. I think what's more important at that initial stage is developing some kind of connection with them. You may think, well, a gift is something that's an easy way to show that I like them, but you know, it may scare them off. There's a higher risk potential of ruining what you have versus talking to them and starting with good conversation, getting them to laugh, finding something you can connect over. Maybe it's, sorry, I didn't mean to hit the mic. Connect over something like, oh, a favorite TV show or a hobby that you guys share or something relating with school. Maybe you both think one teacher is smelly or something that's, you know, funny to talk about. Connect with her over something or connect with him over something. When it comes to gifts, I would wait until you're in a relationship, because the idea is you want to show this person that you appreciate having them in your life. With your crush, they're not directly in your life just yet. You haven't both agreed to be that partner for each other. So I would hold off on gifts for your crush initially. Okay, so I think it's awesome. Thank you guys so much for jumping in and asking questions. I'm gonna check over on YouTube here. I see more of you guys are asking on the actual Google Plus page. I don't know why the questions are disabled for the YouTube stream, but if you guys are watching it over on the YouTube stream and you do wanna ask questions, the Google Hangout link is gonna be in the last video that I did. So if you wanna jump in and ask a direct question, you can either do it on the Hangout or on the page, and I'll check out those questions and I'll try to answer them. So I'm sorry, I don't know why it's not, the comment section isn't enabled. Maybe it is and I'm not seeing it right. But so quickly, I wanna share with you guys one simple thing. 2016, what I've been doing is I've been planning out a lot for the Josh Speaks. What I really wanna do is roll out something for you guys that I feel can really take you from step A to step Z. And what I'm talking about here is building out an online course. Now, originally when I set up my Patreon page, I told myself, okay, I wanna try to have a little bit of money to develop this online course. I feel like I'm gonna try to really up the ante on production and time and investment and really try to bring in, you know, studies that prove thing and quotes and kind of examples and talk to different people, maybe guest speakers on the course. But I didn't really hit my Patreon goal, but that's okay because I think the course over time will kind of take care of itself. I just wanted that initial startup to kind of help me. But so my plan is to roll that out over this year. The first thing I want to do is put out an ebook for you guys. And what this ebook is going to be, it's going to be a dating book. I know this pickup and dating and a lot of dealing with your crush and building confidence is the core of the questions and kind of the comments that I get on my channel. So I really want to give something to you guys that I feel is really going to help you get from A to Z, like I was saying. So what I'm planning on doing with this ebook is kind of rolling out my own ideas of what it takes to kind of build confidence, to ask out your crush, to start a conversation. I want to put in a bunch of different kind of openers and why they work. I remember mentioning this on my previous Google Hangout, either the last time or times ago, but I think that this is going to be a tremendous resource for you guys. So over the next month or so, 2 months, I want to put this together and I want to put it out for you guys. So I'm letting you guys know here first. You're the first ones that are going to know about it. I'm going to put a link in the description as well. If you guys want to sign up to be notified when it's going to be listed, I'm going to put a sign up form down there. You can just submit your email, and I'm only going to email you. If you join that small list, I'm only going to email that list to let you know about the process of building out the online, the dating ebook, which is going to be a collection of my ideas, and also the course that I'm building out later in the future, which is going to be a video component that's going to explain everything from A to Z, from building confidence to asking out your crush to dealing with rejection to, you know, being in a relationship and even dealing with a bad breakup. So I'm putting that all together over the next year, and I'm really excited to put that together for you guys. So on to the next question. So David Cope, David, good to see you in here. Happy you're here, man. Glad you made it. So David is someone I've been talking to by email for a long time. I'll just quickly do another little explanation here. You know, I get a lot of comments and questions every single day, and I try to do my best to answer as many as I can. One thing that I do is I take time every morning on my way to work, and I answer questions from Instagram, AskFM, Ask.fm, Facebook, Twitter, email, and the YouTube section of the videos. And I'll try to get to as many questions as I can. So David is someone that I've been talking to almost every day now on email. He emails me at thejoshspeaks@gmail.com. And, you know, we talk about things, and it's just, he's one of my pen pals, and it's fun to converse with him and to share ideas and to answer questions and to ask questions. So if you do feel like you want to talk to me one-on-one, or you have a personal question you want to talk about, you can reach out to me on any one of those platforms. If you go to my website, thejoshspeaks.com, I'm still a little behind in updating and new videos, but I have an Ask Me a Question section. You can go on that page, go to thejoshspeaks.com/ask a question, or whatever the URL is. Just go to the website and you'll find it. And you can easily choose the platform that's right for you, that's easy for you to communicate. And I will jump on and I'll try to answer your question as soon as I can. So on to the next one. Okay. So Matthew says, what do I do when another girl likes me, but I don't like her? I like someone else, but I don't want to hurt her feelings by going with the girl I like. So Matthew is dealing with a simple case of being caught in the middle here. He likes one girl, but some girl likes him, and he doesn't want to hurt her feelings by going after the one he likes. I know what this is like, Matthew. You're not alone. I've been in this situation before. I think a lot of people have. You know, we all have crushes on different people. Sometimes people have crushes on us. It's a normal thing to happen. And you don't want to look like a bad guy. You don't want to hurt anyone's feelings. I don't think anyone ever intends to hurt someone's feelings when they, you know, don't like someone back. And I think that's an important thing to remember too, guys, that, you know, when you have a crush on a girl or a girl, for girls watching too, if you have a crush on a guy and your crush, well, look at this fuzz flying, and your crush doesn't like you back, don't take it to heart. It's not because you did something wrong. It's not because you're a bad person or you're ugly or anything like that. Sometimes they just don't like you, or they haven't had the chance to really get to know you enough to determine if they like you. But in this case, Matthew wants to know, how does he go after the girl he likes without hurting this other girl that likes him? It's a very tough spot to be in, and I think the best thing to do is to be honest. If the situation creates itself where the girl that likes you is trying to go out with you, is trying to ask you out, is flirting with you, be honest. And honest doesn't mean be mean. Honest doesn't mean be blunt either. Honest simply means let her know that you're not interested. You think she's cool, you know, but all you really see between you two is being friends. Now, I know it hurts when someone says it to you, but that is probably the nicest way to let someone down. You know, not to make an excuse and say, oh, no, I'm busy, or oh, I have an imaginary boyfriend or imaginary girlfriend. To be honest and say, hey, I think you're cool, but I don't see us developing into anything more than just friends, is the simple, straightforward way to be honest here. Now, when it comes to the girl that you like, try talking to her, try flirting with her. If the other girl gets jealous, if the one that likes you gets jealous, there's only so much you can do. You're not responsible if someone else can't accept your honesty. You know, like, you're not responsible because it's like it's their feelings and it's something that they need to work on. Now, you can choose to not hurt their feelings, and that's why I said be honest is the lowest form of hurting their feelings that you can do. But I think it's the best and safest thing. So I think if the situation calls for it, if you see that the girl likes you and she's telling her friends or sending her friends over to ask you, be honest and say, I think you're cool, but I think we can only be friends. So Matthew, I hope that answers your question there. Okay, so I'm going to take a look at the Google Plus page because I see a lot of people jumping in here. Okay, so Basker asked, how would you define someone who is worth your time to be friends with? Okay, that's a very good question. So a lot of times there's a lot of people that come into our lives that may suck out our energy, may suck out our time, and may make us feel like we're not worth it or we're not good enough, or they may make us feel dumb. It's very hard sometimes to determine right off the bat whether or not someone is a good person or is going to be a good fit in your life. The best way to do that is to take time to get to know them. Now, I think it's really a matter of knowing when you've invested enough and being able to really read someone as time has gone on. So for example, let's say you meet someone in your school and you're like, all right, this person's cool. We both like baseball. Okay, baseball. You both like baseball. And it's like, oh, cool. We connect over baseball. Let's be friends. You guys are hanging out, you're talking about baseball, everything's cool. And then one day you see that person, you know, you see your baseball friend, you know, in the hallway, and they're looking at someone else and they're saying, oh, look at that ugly girl. She's so fat, ugly, like mean-spirited comments. And you're like, whoa, dude, like, that's not cool. You don't know her. Don't say that. Now, immediately everything, you know, gets challenged because it's like, wait a second, me and this person connect over baseball. We both like baseball. Why is he being a dick? You know? And it kind of makes you say, oh man, like, is this the kind of person I really want to be my friend? We have this really strong connection, but here we don't. And I think it's at that point that you need to ask yourself, does the person that you connect yourself with, do the people you surround yourself with carry positive values? Are they good people? And the only way to determine if they're good people is to really observe how they treat others. You know, if you're around someone who is kind to other people, then that kind of shows who they are inside, how they view the world. If you're around someone that's constantly making fun of, attacking, belittling, bullying, you know, like just disrespecting others, then that's an indication of whether or not they're a good fit in your life. You don't want to surround yourself with those kinds of people. Now, if you're in a situation where you've been friends with someone for a while and they kind of start acting like a dick after a while and you're like, dude, you've really changed. Like, what happened? You need to be able to accept that sometimes you need to let certain friendships go. And it's perfectly fine. If a person isn't carrying positive values in their own life, then, you know, then it's important to make sure that you cut them loose. You know, and as tough as they may be, it may be having a conversation like, hey, I don't really think we connect as much anymore. I really feel like we're heading in different directions. And I just want you to know that, you know, like, you know, I want to kind of do my own thing for a while. I mean, I'm thinking off the top of my head here, but I feel like that might be the best way to go about it and to start distancing yourself. You know, maybe stop talking to them online first. That could probably be the easiest thing to do. Maybe stop hanging out with them in person. Kind of start separating yourself from them so that you can focus on finding positive people that you enjoy your time around. Okay. So the next question I'm going to, let's jump into future gaming's question here. So, hey Josh, I'm a freshman and there is this girl who I like and she seems to like me back. As a ninth grader, do you think it'd be a good idea to date? So you're a freshman, there's a girl who you like and you think she likes you back. So I did a video called Five Signs a Girl Likes You. I think that's a good starter point to determine whether or not, hey, okay, is she flirting with me? Is she joking? Is she laughing? Is she giving these indicators of interest? If she is, then that's good. I think the biggest indicator of interest is whether or not you like her. Not anything she's doing, but how you actually feel. So if you like a girl and you say, you know what? I like her. I think she's cool. I want to get to know her. That's all the reason you need to go talk to her. You don't need any other reason. You don't need her to flirt with you. You don't need her to look at you constantly or smile. You don't need any of that. All you need to know is, do you like her? If you like her, go forward and talk to her. That's really what it comes down to. Now, being a ninth grader, is it a good idea to date? I would say yes. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think kids are dating in eighth grade and seventh grade, sixth grade even. Everyone has different ideas of what dating means. Sometimes dating means being good friends. Sometimes dating means hanging out together. You know, think about what a date is. A date is two people or three people or a group of people spending time together to do something, to get to know each other better. So is it a good idea to date? Absolutely. If you like a girl, ask her to hang out. Say, hey, you know what? This Friday, I'm doing this thing. You want to come join me? You want to come check it out with me? Hey, I heard this movie is really good. You want to go watch it? Be very casual, be very calm, and very open. You know, you don't have to be very formal and say, I like you. Do you like me? Would you want to be my girlfriend? Do you want to go out with me? You don't have to do that. I think being cool and calm, you know, is the best approach. You know, every time I talk about being your best self, what I really mean at the end of the day is finding a way to develop your comfortable self. The way you are normally, you joke around, you just hang out, you feel cool and relaxed. Being able to put that forward in front of other people, no matter who it is. If it's someone you like, if it's in front of the class, in front of a teacher, feeling that same sense of calm, security, and confidence, like, hey, everything's cool. I'm just going to joke around. I'm going to have fun. I'm going to be myself. That's your best self. And that's the one you want to put forward. And that's the one I want to help you guys develop around anyone you interact with. Because in being your best self, you're going to bring out the best self of others as well. So I think it's perfectly fine for you to be dating as a freshman. If you like her, go for it. That's the only indicator you truly need to go talk to someone. So I'm going to jump in here. So the next question I have is from Aiden. So Aiden says, by the way, Josh, if some people can't find the questions section on the Hangout, then tell them to click on the square thing in the top right corner of the screen and hit Q&A. There you guys go. So Aiden said, if you can't find the question section and you want to ask a question on the Hangout, then click on the square thing at the top right corner of the screen and hit Q&A. Square, So square thing in the top right corner, hit Q&A, and that'll allow you to jump in and ask questions as well. Aiden, thank you so much for helping others out. I think some people might be confused. Google Hangouts in itself is confusing. I'm trying my best here to navigate through the system, but there's no easy way to kind of go through everything here. But I'm going to go to the Google Plus page where it's live streaming and see if there's any. There's a bunch of questions there, so I want to jump in one of those here. So I'm going to pick a long question here, because usually the long questions have a little bit of story to them, and this looks like a good question, so I want to jump in and say this. So Kerr Production Films said, something I've been thinking about lately is about being centered. Basically, what I mean by centered is that, for example, if someone says something like, you're an effing retard, then if you would be centered, you would not be bothered and just as easily make a good comeback or something without being nervous or speechless. Basically, this is basically not being affected by anyone telling you something bad. My question is, how can we practice to be more centered? I think that's an amazing question, and I want to do a video on that question because I think it's so important to develop this kind of center. For me, I think, so going forward in 2016, I'm building my channel on three values. Normally I did self-help, dating, this and that. I'm building it on three specific values: building confidence, building mindfulness, and building compassion. I feel like those are the three values that really emulate being your best self. So when we talk about being centered, we really need to break down what being centered means. So someone may come at you and say, you're an idiot, you're stupid, oh, your mother wears army boots, whatever the hell they want to say, and it's able to kind of hit you and bounce off. So there's a story from the Buddha. Some guy came to visit Buddha, you know, the big jolly guy, he's fat and he sits, he's like smiling all the time. He's like, oh, that guy, always at peace. So the Buddha, someone had come to the Buddha and said, hey, guess what? You're a phony. Everyone, this guy's a phony. He's a phony, just like a family guy. And, you know, he kept lunging these insults at Buddha, and Buddha just sat there and smiled and told him, sir, I want to ask you, when you buy a present for someone and you bring it to them, and they refuse it, who ends up with the present? And the guy goes, well, I do, it's my present, because I bought it for them and they don't want it, then it's still mine because I bought it. And the Buddha responded, exactly. You see, if you come to me with something and I don't accept it, then it falls back on you and it's yours. And the guy kind of understood what he meant, and he said, well, oops, you caught me. Okay. Yeah, you're right. I learned what you mean, because what ends up happening is if someone comes to you with anger or with something mean and they push it at you, if you don't accept it, if you're able to understand that, hey, you know what, they're saying it out of jealousy, they're saying it out of anger, maybe something bothered them, maybe they got a low grade on a test, maybe their parents are going through something tough, maybe they recently had a death in the family, maybe they broke up with their girlfriend, maybe they just had a bad day, and this is why they're coming forward and saying these mean things to me. There's a million ways it could go and a million reasons that could lead someone to be mean. But if you say, you know what, and I'm not going to get hurt, I'm not going to get offended by it, I'm going to accept that this is what they're saying, it's not nice, and I know that they're dealing with something, then the anger falls back on them. It's no longer on you. And when the anger falls back on them, guess what's going to happen? They're going to realize, over time, you know what, that wasn't cool of me. Because when someone lashes out against you and you accept it, you're kind of feeding the anger. You know, I'm being mean, and by you responding, okay, I feel relaxed because I know that what I said was actually heard. But if what I'm saying is mean and no one's accepting it, then I have to stop and think about my actions. It allows a person to process what they're doing, what they're going through, and say, shit, I shouldn't have said that. That was kind of messed up. And by this person not treating me bad as well, I realized that what I was doing was wrong. So I think the key to being centered is really building this sense of mindfulness and being able to tell yourself, I understand that there's more to the story here. I understand that there's more going on in their life. And their reason for being mean is not because maybe I did something, but because they're dealing with something on their own. Now, it's not your responsibility to help them solve their problem. It's not your responsibility to find out what their problem is. That's not your responsibility. Well, your responsibility is to understand what's being lunged at you and understand how you can move forward and create positivity in the world. Just like I was saying before, surround yourself with positive people and develop positivity in your interactions with others, because that's gonna cycle through and bring positivity to others as well. So I hope that answers the question. So Philip Borgensen, if you don't know how to watch this, it may not, I'm not sure if it's working. I hope it is. If you just go to the Google Plus page, you should be able to click play and it should be live. Or if you go to my YouTube channel right now, you should be able to just stream it there. I don't know if you can ask questions on the YouTube channel. It's a little confusing. But John Cena, where is he? I saw the John Cena icon. John Cena Gaming. I want to answer his question because he was one of the first people to say he was going to jump at the Hangout. To anyone new, I want to say, guys, hey, players, welcome. The numbers are growing, more people are jumping in. Thank you guys so much for joining. If you're new here, hit the thumbs up and let me know that you, you're enjoying it. You can hit the plus sign, plus number, plus five, plus six, whatever it's at on the Google Plus page. One thing I really would like is if you guys can share this on Facebook or Twitter, share this stream, because I'm going to be live for a while and you may have friends that also want to ask questions. And I think this is the perfect opportunity to kind of get it out there with your friends, get it out there so other people can join in. I really want to build the Josh Speaks out. I'm setting huge goals for myself to develop amazing things for you guys and to really create strong values that I feel will help you guys be your best self. That is going to include building confidence. That's going to include being mindful and developing compassion for others. That's how you're going to be your best self. So I really want to put that out there. Blue Raja's asking a lot of questions that aren't nice, like, what's the fastest way to give a girl AIDS? That's not nice, Blue Raja. I'm going to delete that question. That's not a nice question. But anyway, we got some good questions there. John Cena Gaming, I can't forget you. I could see you. John Cena Gaming asked, I'm in middle school and I want to ask this girl out. The problem is, how would I deal with my parents? It's not written right. And where would I go for a date if she said yes? Also, lastly, where should I ask her out in middle school? Okay, so I'll rephrase that question. John Cena Gaming likes a girl. He's in middle school. And there's a few challenges sometimes with dating in middle school, and I'll kind of run through them. And let me know if these are the challenges you face as well. You're young, so you don't have access to easily travel. You know, maybe you need your parents to bring you somewhere. So it's kind of hard to say, let's go on a date to the movies because you need someone to drive you. Or, hey, let's go get ice cream at the corner, not the corner store, but like the mall or something like that. And you can't just go out on your own because maybe you're too young for that. Also, let's think about dating for a second. What does that mean? What does it mean to be dating someone in middle school? Does that mean you guys have to be making out or kissing? You know, like there's this kind of line where it's like you like each other. You're developing that sense of being able to like other people, but you don't know how to go about it. So, and then also let's add in the parents factor. Your parents may say, sorry, bud, you're too young to be dating. Or sorry, girl. Sorry, daughter. You're too young to be dating. I don't want you dating until you're 16 or 17 or 18. You can't date until you leave the house, whatever it may be. There's a lot of factors that really interfere with middle schoolers wanting to have boyfriends and girlfriends. So I'm going to quickly just kind of run through what I think you could do. When it comes to dating in middle school, I think what the most important thing, the very, very core thing to be able to do with someone is to develop a friendship. Friendship will be the root of you guys dating, because just because you call yourselves boyfriend and girlfriend doesn't mean anything. Essentially, the root of that word, boyfriend, girlfriend, is friend. So you want to first focus on building a good friendship with someone. Now, them being your boyfriend or girlfriend could mean you guys like being friends, but hanging out alone with each other. And that's okay too. For some, the best way to hang out with your boyfriend or girlfriend may just be in school. You may not be able to see them on the weekends or after school. So it's perfectly fine and perfectly acceptable to ask someone to be your girlfriend or boyfriend or to date while you're in school. That can mean seeing each other in between classes. That could mean talking online. That could mean hanging out at lunch or playing video games with each other online. There's a lot of different ways to go about it. Don't feel pressured or bound in any way to feel like, well, she's my girlfriend, I have to be making out with her, I have to be doing this, I have to be buying her things, I have to be taking her on dates. Everyone has a different idea. And if you're dating someone and you're in middle school and you know you're not sure what to do as a date, you can simply just hang out with each other online. There's a lot of things you could do online together that can simulate dating. Like, for example, you know, open up Photoshop and make her a picture. You know, that's something you can do that's a fun gift to give her, and it's free. Going on a date, you guys can find a website where you can play a game online together and play it together. That's a date. You know, you're spending time together. You're getting to know this person. Now, when it comes to your parents saying, sorry, you're a little too young to be dating, if your parents don't allow you to date and you're in middle school, that's okay. You know, you don't have anything to worry about. What I would say then is focus on just building a strong, strong friendship with the girl or guy that you like, and just building that out. Because as you get older, as you get closer and closer to them and you develop a stronger friendship, what's going to end up happening is when you are old enough to date, you'll have all these years worth of experience with each other to say, hey, now let's date for real. So you want to kind of slow build that up until you both are ready. So I think that's what's important to remember if your parents don't allow you to date or if you're limited in your dating options. So I hope that answers your question. I know there's a lot of middle schoolers here, and I hope I want to do more videos for you guys as well. So stay tuned. I'm going to be kind of really delving more into like these very specific topics that you guys have and questions you have. I really appreciate everything you guys are saying, how you guys are helping the channel grow. And you guys are, one thing I love about this community is that there's so many people jumping in and sharing their stories and advice with one another. And I think that's an amazing thing because I'm only one person. You know, I can't answer everything. It's just not physically possible. But seeing that you guys are having conversations and you're saying, hey, I tried this with my crush, or hey, I said this and it didn't work, so don't say that. That's the most amazing thing here. I think the community that we're building, this kind of learning community, is really something that's so special and so amazing. And so I'm going to use that as a little segue here, because what I want to let you guys know is that me and my friend Aiden on Patreon, we're going to be developing a very small group. It's going to start off small, hopefully a bit bigger, and develop into different kind of sections and chapters as time goes on. But what we want to start doing is holding a monthly Google Hangout. So here I am just streaming one person on camera. We want to hold a monthly Google Hangout where up to 10 people or so will be on camera, and we're going to be tackling one specific question every single time. Maybe it'll be a half an hour question brain trust meeting, or like a learning co-op where we all work together to give our input and answers and everything like that. But essentially, that's what it's going to be. I'm going to share the link for the video. Yes, I'm going to share the link for the video. I know there's a way to share videos on the Google Hangout while you're streaming, but I don't want to do anything to mess it up. So instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a separate video where I'm going to talk more in detail about what this whole project is. I'm going to include the video from my friend Aiden. He's going to be helping me kind of manage it and organize it. What we're going to start with is going to be a Facebook group. And the Facebook group is going to be invite only at first. It's going to be for the people who want to support me over on Patreon, and also for a select number of people. So I'm going to go through the comments and see who is really giving a lot of information, who's really helping other people. I'm going to personally invite them to be part of this group. Because if I see that you're someone that's willing to ask questions about others and say, hey, did you try this? Or, you know, like, hey, this is my advice on that. I want to personally invite those people. I want them in this little meeting, because what we're going to do is we're going to do a small little Google Hangout. We're going to answer single questions like, what's the best opener? How do you deal with rejection? You know, like these questions, and I want a bunch of people to kind of share their experiences. Hey, I remember talking to a girl and I tried this and it didn't work. I'm going to share my experience. It's going to be very personal, and I'm really excited for it. If you guys are really interested in being a part of that, you know, leave it in the comments. Let me know if it's something you're interested on. Head over to the Patreon page, patreon.com/thejoshspeaks. Get involved. I'll include you in the process. I think it's going to be an amazing thing. My friend Aiden kind of, you know, helped me spark this idea and really turn it into something. It was mainly his idea. And I kind of said, you know what, this is perfect. I want to go with it. He's the brainchild of it. And I think it's an amazing thing. I can't wait to put it forward for you guys. And I'm really excited for this. So Minecraft, BRB, I'll see you in a few. So Minecraft asked another question. I don't want to jump ahead of anyone, but I see this sticking out here and I just want to say, so Minecraft asked, how do I find out if someone likes me, and how do I tell my friends I'm bisexual? Okay, So it's a two-part question. I'll break down each one here. So how do I find out if someone likes me? A good way to find out if someone likes you, I personally think, is to just talk to them and get to know them better. A lot of times we want to kind of try to figure things out and be like Sherlock Holmes about it and be like, well, I'm going to look at their actions and talk to their friends and do everything around them. But I think the best way is to kind of just talk to them one-on-one. In talking to them, you'll see, are they open when they talk back to me? Are they very reserved? Are they kind of looking around, not paying attention? Do they feel nervous? Kind of read their body language and you'll see if they feel comfortable around you. The more time you spend around them, the more you'll learn whether or not things are meshing well and you guys are working together. So the next question he asks is, how do I tell my friends I'm bisexual? So this is something that luckily a lot of people are becoming more and more comfortable with being open about. And it's perfectly normal, perfectly fine to have any feelings towards anyone. You know, we're all humans. We're all living beings. We all love each other to an extent. And some people romantically love each other in different ways. And that's perfectly fine. But sometimes we be afraid of how certain people will respond to us if we say I'm bisexual, I'm gay, I'm lesbian, I'm transgender, whatever it may be. We always feel like I'm afraid my friends may think it's weird, or they may not understand it, or they may make fun of me, or they may hate me. And this is a real fear that a lot of people have. And this is where I was saying before, it's a matter of observing how your friends interact with other people. So for example, if you have friends that are the kind of people that make fun of other people because of their weight, or their appearance, or their gender, or their looks, or how smart they may appear, if those are the kind of people you're with and they're constantly attacking and belittling others, then you may want to rethink, you know what, are these the kind of friends, if I were to tell them I'm bisexual, if this is how I feel, are they the kind of people that really would accept me? You know, and it's not a matter of prejudging your friends before you know how they will respond, but it's a matter of gauging beforehand, okay, is this probably how they're going to respond, you know, so that when they do respond, A, you're not as hurt. You're kind of like, okay, cool, I was expecting this. Maybe it takes a little bit more time for them to understand, but I think that's very important to do. Observe your friends, observe their behavior. If you feel like your friends are cool and they're not the kind of people that will be jerks about things like, you know, making fun of other people or I don't understand, that's stupid, whatever it may be, they're not those kind of people, then I think it's perfectly fine. Sometimes it's easier to tell people in a group, to say, hey guys, I just want to let everyone know that this is how I feel. This is, you know, what I'm bisexual. I like guys and girls or whatever it may be. I'm pansexual, I'm lesbian, I'm gay, I'm transgender, whatever it may be. This is how I feel. I want you guys to know so that you can be cool with that. You can be okay and everyone's on the same page. That's one way. Another way may be to sit down with your friends one-on-one and to tell them. Sometimes it's easier to talk to people one-on-one because they may have questions and they may be afraid to ask it. They may be afraid to ask in a group setting. So you may say and they may go, oh, okay. But in their minds, they have a million questions that they want to talk to you personally about. So sometimes one-on-one works best as well. But I'd say that's how you would kind of figure it out. If someone likes you, talk to them, get to know them better. If you want to tell your friends how you feel about something, what your sexual orientation is, observe how they interact with others. And then that'll kind of help you see, you know, how they'll respond to what you say and how you feel. So, let me go back down here. So Justin Doa said, let's open up his question here. So, hey Josh, I've been good friends with this girl for a year and a half. I'm in the eighth grade and known her since seventh. And I want to ask her out, but I know for sure that she doesn't like me. Should I try to change her mind or should I move on? So this sounds like a case where it's like, maybe the girl has already decided, dude, we're better off as just friends. Or maybe she's rejected you once you asked her out. Or maybe you just know that she doesn't like you and she likes someone else. And she's openly said that to her friends or to someone else. Should you keep pursuing? Should you be persistent here? I think if you're going on the whim of, I just know she doesn't like me, I think you should keep being persistent. I think you should keep going. Because if you're the only one telling yourself, oh, I don't think she likes me, that's not enough. That's not sufficient evidence. That's not an idea. It could be your own fears creating this image of, oh, she's not going to like me. I'm a loser. She's not going to like me. I'm too nerdy or whatever it may be. You're only creating that perception for yourself. So the best way around that is to be persistent, to keep talking to her, to keep getting to know her better and to take the time to ask her out, you know, ask her to hang out and see how she responds then. That's probably the best way to go about it, I think. If you're already telling yourself she doesn't like you and you haven't tried anything, you haven't tried talking to her, then I think you're only shooting yourself in the foot. You won't be able to walk. So don't do that prematurely. Get to know her before you make any kind of big decisions or anything like that. So David, my friend David over here said, how can I be best friends again with an ex-friend, Josh, when they're angry and upset with me? Okay, so sometimes you get into fights with your friends. It's normal. We get into a fight. We get into fights with our family members. We get into fights with teachers. We get into fights with friends and strangers. Normally, it's anger is a normal feeling, and it happens sometimes. Sometimes you just get angry, and it's okay. It's okay to feel that way. What matters more is not so much the feeling. The feeling is going to happen. You're going to respond. You're going to feel a certain way. What matters is how you choose to handle the feeling after. So if it's a feeling of anger, you need to ask yourself, when I'm angry, how do I act? What do I do? How do I go forward with my anger? Those are important questions to ask. So what I would say is, how do you deal with an ex-friend who's angry at you and upset? And, you know, you want to develop the friendship again. You want to be best friends again. I think the most important thing is to sometimes give them their space to cool off, their space to just relax and unwind, to really think about, maybe you guys got into a fight over something. Maybe you said something mean, maybe they said something mean. To give yourself time to cool down, to be level-headed. And it's only in being level-headed and that you guys will be able to reconnect. When two people try to connect and try to solve something when they're both angry, no one is listening. Everyone is at the top of their offensive meter and they're just trying to yell at each other. No one is listening. So it's important to be in a state where you're both open to listening. And the best way to do that is when you both are calm and have had time to cool off. So I think once you've allowed enough time to cool off, to message them again and say, hey, dude, is it cool if we talk again? I want to talk to you about what happened. I want us to be friends and I want us to kind of work through everything. Do that when you both are level headed and you both are cool. Do not engage when you're angry, because anger and anger does not equal peace. So let's jump into the next question here. Let's see what else we got. Okay, so Mason Fritz asked, what is an example of a conversation starter? I think that's a great question. So when we think about conversation starters, what we're talking about is, how do you open a conversation? I think the key to a great conversation starter is asking something or talking about something that the other person will share their opinion on or give their own advice or give their two cents in some way. So a good conversation starter is not, hi, I think you're pretty. That's not a good conversation starter. I mean, in some very few cases that works, you know, like these situations where it's like, you're really cocky guy. It's like, hey, I think you're gorgeous. And the girl's like, really me? Or the girl's like, you know, you're a good looking guy. And the guy's like, yeah. Very rare cases, 99.9% of the cases, that doesn't work. And it's not a good conversation starter because it doesn't give a situation for the other person to respond. What are they going to say? Thank you? That's it. But if I say something like, hey, listen, I need your opinion on something. Me and my friends are going to the movies this weekend, and there's a lot of good movies out right now. What would you go and watch in the theaters? Now, they may say something like, oh, I don't know what movies are in theaters right now, or, oh, my friend said Star Wars is good, or I don't go to the movies. Regardless of what their answer is, that allows you to build a follow-up question because they're sharing their opinion of some sort. So let's say they say, I don't know. That's it. Let's say they only say, I don't know. You can say, well, there's a few movies that I know of. There's Star Wars, there's Creed, there's other things that are in the theaters right now, whatever it is in the theater right now. And you can list out a few and say, I'm a huge fan of action movies. What type of movies do you like? So your question allows you to kind of get an answer from them and to build off of it. So that's a good conversation starter, even if they're giving you minimal things like, I don't know, I don't watch movies. I don't know, any of these kind of minimal things, you can keep following up because there's content there. There's, oh, these are the movies that I know are out. Have you ever heard of this one? Have you ever seen this one? What are your thoughts on these types of movies? You know, the movies thing is just an example. You could say that with food or anything else that you feel comfortable talking about, video games or TV shows or something like that, or music even, you know? So I think just play to something that you feel you would enjoy talking about rather than like, this is something that they like and I'm in, I don't know anything about it. You know, start off with a question. So I think the root of a good conversation starter or opener is building out a question that you can get some kind of response from the other person from. I'm going to link out in the description the two videos that I've done on starting conversations and how to keep them going, how to stop them from being boring. I think I give a few good tips on what to do and how to kind of direct the conversation so it doesn't fall flat. So you can check that out there. So let's check out another question here. Let's see. So Crazy Marshmallow asked, I like this girl a lot at my school and she likes me too, but we are both really shy to talk to each other and I'm scared to death to ask her out. And I think she is too. Help! He wrote, help! So I've gotten this question a lot. It's something I definitely want to do a video on. This idea of I'm too scared to talk to my crush and my crush is too scared to talk to me. Therefore, neither of us are making a move. What do we do? This is a big thing. I know a lot of you guys deal with this. A lot of you guys experience this kind of situation where it's like, what do? I'm too scared. I don't know how to start this whole thing. And you may be waiting for them to do something. They may be waiting for you. Here's what I think you should know. Because you're aware of the fact that you're both shy, I think that gives you a head start as to what you can do, as to who should start this whole thing. So for example, if you know that they're too shy to talk to you and you're too shy yourself, you can use that as kind of leverage in the conversation. And you can say, you know what? I know they're shy and I like them. So my goal here is to allow them to feel comfortable around me. That's ultimately what you want. You want them to feel comfortable around you so that you can both open up to each other. So someone has to start that initial interaction. And because you know that they're shy already, I feel like you have the ability to do that. So even going up to them and saying, hey, my name is this, or hey, I wanted to ask you a question. Let me get your opinion on something, the opener I just talked about before. They're shy, so they're going to reciprocate. You know, if you aim to create a calming environment around them, a calming presence, they're going to respond to that because what they're hoping is that someone's going to take off the burden of talking first. Oh, take that away from them. So you have the ability to do that even if you're shy. It's a term called fake it till you make it. You know, it's this idea of I'm going to act confident even though I'm not confident right now because I know that in acting confident, it's going to allow the other person to open up. So I think it's important to practice that. It may take time to get into those shoes. Maybe a good way to practice is to talk to other people in your class, to say hi to them sometimes, to wave and smile and ask people random questions like, hey, you ever wonder why they use number 2 pencils on Scantrons? Like crazy things like that, just to get into the habit of talking to others. Once you feel comfortable doing that, then it may be easier for you to approach your crush, even if you're both shy. So Neon Wave, good to see you again. Neon Wave is always here. I always see him in the Google Hangouts and always in the comments section. So Neon, you're definitely someone that I would want to invite into the private Google Hangout. I was quickly just talking about how I want to gather a small group of people together to jump on camera and to kind of talk to each other, to answer one question, share our experiences and stuff. It's going to be kind of this like learning co-op. That's the tentative name. We'll see if that sticks. And we'll kind of just all answer a question together. I think that's going to be really, really cool. So good to see you here, Neon Wave. So I Like Iguanas 23 says, how can I be less awkward with my girlfriend? We've been dating for a month now and we are still sometimes awkward together and we're both a bit shy. We tend to be less awkward when we're alone on a date as opposed to in public. Okay, so things are awkward. You guys are dating. It's kind of weird. You don't know what to do sometimes when you're around other people. It's kind of a weird thing. I get what that's like. You know, I remember being in high school and like being around my girlfriend, it's like, do I hold her hand? Do I kiss her? What do I do? This is kind of weird. I get what that's like, man. I know exactly what you're feeling. One thing I would really suggest is, you know, when it comes to eliminating awkwardness, the best way to, and nervousness around each other, The best way to do that is to take time to get to know a person better. So you may want to look up online and search for 20 questions. Just type in 20 questions. You'll probably find a bunch of websites that list that, like 20 questions like, what country would you travel to if you could travel to any country in the world? Random questions like that. And I would go back and forth and answer them with each other. Because what it's going to do is you're going to find some questions that are going to cause you both to laugh. And you're both going to be like, holy crap, I didn't know you would do that, or you've been there before. You're going to learn a little bit more about each other. And I think in learning about each other, it's going to make it so much easier for you to interact with this person. And I think it's only natural that as you interact with someone more, you feel more comfortable around them. It's easier to put your arm around them. It's easier to hold their hand. You know, you may still disconnect the idea of communicating with romantic gestures like that. Like, oh, cool, we can talk, but I don't know when to hold their hand. But it'll be easier. And the more that you get to know a person better, the little bit more they're willing to accept your daringness. So if you're cool talking to them, they may be more accepting of you just putting your arm around them. They may be like, all right, I don't mind. I don't think it's weird. And that only comes with getting to know someone better. So I would say try 20 questions. Take time to get to know your partner better. When it comes to feeling comfortable in public, that's something you guys, it kind of starts with this initial idea of feeling comfortable around each other. Once you can feel really comfortable around each other, it's easier to be around other people. It does take time, but it's something that you can do. So let's jump over to the Google Plus page here and see what people are saying. So got a lot of questions come in. Man, I wish I could sit here for 12 hours and answer them all, but I'm going to try my best to get as many as I can. So Sean Dobson asked, so I like this girl and I'm pretty sure she likes me as well, but her parents don't seem comfortable with her going places with me, especially if it's just the two of us together. How should I deal with this? Oh, and we dated in sixth grade 2 years ago, but we've been on good terms since we broke up. Should I text, FaceTime, call her, ask her out, give her a gift? Any other advice? So Sean wants to know how he can kind of get this girl to feel comfortable, get her parents to feel comfortable with them being together. He's dated her in the past, and now it's like, well, you know, that was in the past 2 years later. Now you guys are trying to develop, you want to develop something again with her. And it can be tough. Should you FaceTime her? Should you chat with her? Talk to her in school? There's a bunch of different options here. I think if you like her, again, those feelings kind of came back. I would start with just generally interacting with kind of her presence. So that may be, oh, you see she posted a status, respond and answer something on it. Ask a question. Be interactive with that. Like her pictures if you see them. Be interactive with her kind of social presence. And then the next big step, the very big step, is to talk to her in school when you see her. So if you see her in the hallways, stop her for a second and say, hey, cool, I wanted to talk to you about blah, 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 you know, whatever it may be. That interaction in person is so essential to this, because just doing it online may not be enough. It may be easy for her to write it off. It may be easy for her to kind of say, oh, he's talking to me again, but let me think back to what happened. It's like you allow her mind to kind of make the decision as to where you stand, rather than you being in front of her and talking to her and her going, hey, he's still cool. He's still a guy that I liked before. So it's important to, you know, start interacting with her so that she recognizes, oh, cool, he's still around. I miss him. I want to look at his pictures, Facebook stalk him a little bit, get to see what he's up to. And then talk to her in person. That's so essential. So the next question here, Ajay Ragunanan asks this. Let's take a look. Hey Josh, I've known this girl for a while and I really like her. We barely see each other, but we text. When we talk, she sends me the kissy face emoji and hearts. I really want to tell her that I like her, but I'm shy. What should I do? Please help. So Ajay has known this girl for a while and she sends him things like kissy emojis and stuff like that. I want to do a video too on emojis. I feel like how to determine if emojis that the girl uses is a sign that she likes you. I don't know. I'm going to work with the title and topic, but here's what I think. Emojis can be incredibly misleading, and I'll tell you why. Emojis are just these little icons that kind of display a kind of feeling or facial expression or kind of response to something. So someone may say, just, you know, got a new haircut, and then put the Clippers sign. Or someone may say, like, love ya, put the smiley face, the kissy face. They can be very misleading. They can make you think, oh, this person's posting this emoji because they really like me or they want to be with me. And it sounds like the girl may use kissy faces and hearts and these kind of aw and those things. I'm only assuming that that may be how she interacts with you. And you may think, like, is she doing that because she likes me? What's the deal with these emojis? Maybe wondering. But I think they can be very misleading. I think emojis are not a good enough sign that show that someone likes you. I think what's a better sign is interacting with them in person and seeing if they flirt, if they are interested in the conversation, if they're jumping in more. That's a better way. So if the girl is sending you a lot of emojis, kissy faces, hearts, you know, hugs, you know, smiley faces, winky faces, all these different things, I would honestly say take them with a grain of salt. They are not the end all be all. You know, they are not a deciding factor. Because it's very easy to just click the emoji icon and just drop one in there that kind of showcases you being cutesy or, like, you know, whatever it may be. So take them with a grain of salt. Do not rely so much on the power of emojis to help you determine whether or not you like someone. So if you are shy and you want to talk to this girl and she is doing those kinds of things, the best thing may be to try to transition your online conversation into an in-person conversation. That may be saying something online like, hey, what are you doing tomorrow? Let's meet up after school and get something to eat or something like that. That way you're transitioning from your social interaction to your in-person interaction there. And that's how you can start really building this bridge that's beyond just emojis, you know. Okay, so there's a lot of more questions coming in. Let's see. Okay, Aiden, let's jump into your question again. Another one. So I like this freshman girl on my track team, and I've talked to her friend who is a freshman guy, and he seems really cool. I invited him to my house for a New Year's Eve party, and I want him to bring this girl. How do I ask him to invite her without being weird? All right, so the situation is he likes the girl. So Aiden's talked to me before about, like, you know, different things going on in his life. This is the Aiden I was talking about. It's going to help me out with the whole Google Hangout group thing that I'm talking about. You know, what's going on in his life, different, he's on track and everything like that. So he likes this girl, and he invited her friend over to his house for New Year's with the hope that the friend will bring the girl. In a case like this, I think it's okay to be a little bit more direct. You know, this is the new year after all, you know, like, it's a time to start taking chances. You know, you got to do it, you know? So if the guy is going to come, you can always say to him, hey, you know what? Tell this girl to come as well because I want to get more people here. He'll definitely ask her. I don't see why he wouldn't ask her if he says, like, why do you want her to come? Just say, because I think she's cool and I want her to come to my New Year's, come to my New Year's party. What's up? You know, that's it. So I would really push to ask him, say, like, tell him to bring her too. If he's like, oh, why do you like her? Be like, I think she's cool. I want to get to know her. I want her at my New Year's party. It'll be fun. You know, just be very cool about it. Definitely ask him. I definitely think that's the way to go. It'll only be weird if you kind of don't tell him why you want her there. So if he's like, oh, cool, yeah, I'll invite her, but why do you want her there? And you're like, no reason, just invite her. Then that kind of looks fishy. That kind of looks weird. It's like, there's no reason why you want her there, but you want me to invite her? That's a little weird. But if you say something like, I think she's cool and she seems like a fun person, invite her for New Year's, it'll be cool. That's all the reason you need. It's like, she's cool and fun, come to my New Year's party. Very simple equation, you know? So if the person kind of gives you a hard time, just roll with that. I think that'd probably be the best way to handle something like that. So I like iguanas. Awesome, man. I'm glad my answers were helpful in some way. So one thing I wanted to quickly talk to you guys about was this idea. We're already on the second hour now of the Josh Speaks Hangout here. Thank you so much, everyone that's tuned in. Once again, if you're enjoying the things that I'm saying, if you're new to the channel, first off, subscribe. Definitely subscribe because I give advice and tips and, you know, all these different things every week for you guys. Now, if you really are really gaining something from my answers and responses and learning something here. I definitely want you guys to share this. Now, I know this is one of the problems that we run into here is that sometimes what we talk about on the channel feels kind of private. Like, you may not want your friends knowing that you're asking for advice or help, and it may seem weird to be like, they may be like, why are you asking some guy how to talk to a girl? It's weird. I get that. But what I would say is, if you can share it, if you do want to share it under the context of, this person is helping me really expand my mind and see things differently. You know, we're talking about these big level concepts of how to interact with people, how to develop social skills, how to build confidence. And that's just cool stuff to talk about. So share it under that context. You don't need to say, he's teaching me how to ask out a girl. You don't need to say that if you don't feel comfortable. Share it under the context of, we're having fun here. We're talking about things. You're enjoying your time. I'm enjoying my time. We're just, you know, we're both vibing. We're all vibing here, and we're just helping each other. That's the goal, to help each other be our best selves. So share it under that context if you can. So I'm going to jump into the next question. So Blaster says, Blaster6009, another question says, Josh, I'm a gamer and I had a problem finding a girlfriend that likes to play video games. What should I do to find a girl that likes video games and is the right one? Okay, so some girls love video games, some girls don't. You know, that's just the nature of things. Disproportionately, it seems like a lot more guys like video games, and it's very guy-centric, but there's a huge number of girls that love video games, that play video games. They may not talk about it as much, but girls love games just as much as guys do. Now, it may be hard sometimes to find a girl that you like, maybe in your school or something like that, that also loves video games as much as you do. I don't think that should hold you back from talking to different girls, because if you're approaching it from the sense of, I want to know first if she likes video games and then I'll try to go out with her, you may be doing it backwards. It may be more important to get to know someone first to see if that they may like video games. They may like trying out video games. They may like playing them. And that may be something that they want to, sorry about this, drop something here. That may be something that they want to develop over time. Then they may be someone you want to invest time into, because they may first be like, I don't really play video games, but they may start to see you play and be like, this is cool, I want to join in. So don't write someone off just because they may not like video games initially. Get to know someone first, and don't worry so much about finding the right one. Find one that works, one that you can enjoy your time with, you know? This idea of the right one may put too much pressure on you. You may say, I don't want to settle down with a girl. I don't want to go out with a girl until I know she's exactly what I want. I think it's not fair, because no one is ever exactly what someone wants. We're all different people with all different ideas. So you have to be respectful of that. And you learn to cater and move to someone else's cadence as you get to know them better. Okay. So let's jump to Daryl Jarrett's question. Daryl asks, can you talk about not stressing and having regrets about most of the things you do? Oh, this was the first question we asked. Not stressing and buyer's remorse and learning to accept that you can only change things kind of in the present. And going forward, you can't change things in the past. So being comfortable with that. So Daryl, the question popped up here, but definitely go. And once the live stream is over, check out the beginning. I think that was the very first question that I answered here. Let's see what else. Let's look at the Google Plus page here. I see a lot of people. Sean Dobson's in there. Captain Potato. Is that a potato? Oh, Brotato. Cardo O'Neill says, hi, Cardo. Josh, I posted a question on Google Plus, and it's urgent in two parts. So William Randall, okay. So so Captain Brotato, I'm just gonna jump in and answer that because that's just a cool name. How can I rebuild my reputation? Okay, so I did a video a while ago on how to deal with rumors. And in that video, I kind of talk about this idea that people might be talking about you, there may be certain things going around in the school, people might be making fun of you for certain things. And that may destroy your reputation. And the advice that I give in that video is I talk about rebuilding your reputation as kind of talking to people directly about what the rumor is and kind of squashing it. So if someone's saying, oh, I heard this person did something really messed up, if you talk to someone and say, hey, listen, this is the rumor that's kind of going around. It's not true, dude. Like, trust me, it's not true. You can squash it on an individual level. You may not be able to squash it on this big, grand level of the whole school, but you can do it on a small scale for the people that matter to you. So when it comes to rebuilding your reputation, I think it's the same kind of approach. You need to say, okay, well, everyone's going to have their own opinions. I can't change the world. That's not my problem. I can't even change my whole school. That's not my problem. The people that I care about are the ones who I really want to know the truth. They're the ones who I want to respect me and to know me better. So let's say you did do something stupid or messed up or whatever it may be, and you want to rebuild your reputation. I would start with the people that matter to you. I would start with your friends, the friends of your friends, the people in your class, and you start to work your way up. I keep hitting the microphone. Start to work your way up, talking to everyone one-on-one and saying, hey, listen, dude, I want us to be cool. I'm not the person that I was, or what I did before does not define me. You know, I'm better than that. And start to rebuild that one-on-one trust with everyone again. It's a long due process, but it's way more rewarding because you're investing more time in each person, and that allows them to really say, okay, I can trust him more because he's talking to me directly. And that's kind of what you want. You want people to trust you more because you're talking to them directly. So Justin asked, how was my Christmas? My Christmas was great. I had an amazing time. I got a lot of cool gifts, a lot of cool presents, stuff relating to Mr. Rogers. I love Mr. Rogers. He's one of the huge inspirations in my life. And I got a few things under him. I got a Teak Knight Han comic book. If you guys know who Teak Knight Han is, I did the video review dealing the video called Dealing with Anger, where I reviewed his book, Anger. He's a Buddhist monk who I've learned a lot from. He's really taught me the values of compassion, understanding, being kind and compassionate, like I said, towards others. So I got a lot of cool things. Christmas was a lot of fun. Josh, are you tired? Yes and no. I feel like I'm always a little bit tired, but I'm really pumped right now. I'm pumped because you guys are asking really awesome questions. We're really talking in depth. I know it might be late for some of you. I know like some people said they're in Europe right now, so it's like 3 or 4 in the morning. And if you guys are on this, you guys are crazy, I swear. And hopefully you're on winter break and you don't have to wake up for anything early. I commend you. Some of you, it's the early morning. Like David, I know you're in Australia, so I think it's the early morning for you. So thanks for watching this too. The next cool hangout I do that's going to be like this kind of setup, I want to do probably in the middle of the day on a weekend. I feel like maybe it'll be easier for people to jump in. I guess we'll see. We'll see what happens. So, okay. So speaking of David in Australia, this is an important question. I think a lot of us can relate to it. So I want to tackle this. So David says, hey, Josh, I hope you can help me. I lost my grandfather, his mom's dad, in 2002, and he still misses him every day. Is it normal to still feel sad and depressed after a loved one has passed away? And also, I find it hard to move on in my life after a family member has passed. So this is a little bit more of a serious question, I think. A lot of us have dealt with family members passing away. A lot of us have experienced someone that we really love, whether it's a family member, a pet, a friend, or a neighbor, someone that went to your school, someone that's been in your life pass away. Death is a normal part of life. As cruel and as suckish as that sounds, it's a normal part of life. And sooner or later, people will die. And it sounds kind of grim, dark, but it's the truth. And I think there's nothing wrong with feeling bad or hurt or still feeling sad even years after a person has passed away. It's perfectly normal, it's perfectly okay. What matters most is that you have people in your life that you can turn to talk to, people that you know you can confide in and be open with, and to share your feelings, no matter how much the situation may hurt you, no matter how long it's been since it happened. The most important thing is to surround yourself with good people that will be there for you. Sometimes we don't have that. Sometimes we feel like we're dealing with things alone. And I think in situations like that, you may want to try to reach out to people that you've never thought about reaching out to before. So that may be speaking to a teacher about it. That may be seeing if you can go to a guidance counselor in your school about it, talking to your friends about it. You know, the most important thing is to have caring people in your life, because other people will sometimes have to rely on you to be that caring person. And it sucks when we lose a loved one, and having that support is the most important thing. So if you are lucky enough to be someone who hasn't dealt with any kind of death in any way before, offer to be the support for others who have. I think that's the most important thing you can do, because when you are on that side of the line, you're going to want to be able to turn to someone too. So David, I know how tough it must be even after all these years, but know that you have caring and loving people in your life that do care about you and that will help you when you feel that way. Okay, so let's jump into another question here. Let's see. William Randall asked on the page, but I'm not sure where to find it here. Okay, here. So Bolt Zekrom, this looks like it's a good, very good question. What's up, Josh? I've been having a problem for a long time. I really want to start working out since I'm a bit overweight, but I can't get myself into the gym. I have a lot of schoolwork and it takes away my time. Some people laugh at me when I ask them if they want to be my gym partner, and I'm an introvert. Since I really don't want to do this alone, I end up not doing it at all. Please help. So Bolt, I can imagine that there's a lot of people here that also feel that way too. Going to the gym is not always an easy thing to do. You know, it requires a lot of work and dedication. And even after you've gone for a few days, your body is sore and you're tired, and it's a hard thing to do. But knowing that you can do it, being able to say, I can stick to it, is so rewarding, and it outweighs the negative faults of feeling tired and sore. You'll feel so energized once you're able to get into that cycle, and it's so empowering. Now, the other situations you're dealing with, you're feeling introverted or being an introvert and having people kind of maybe laugh at you when you say you want to be their gym partner, they may not take you seriously. And that's bad on their part. You know, like, that's just not a cool thing to do. But here's what I think. If you find out that it maybe is a bit of a struggle for you to start working out at the gym, start with something very simple, which would simply be home workouts. Every single day, do push-ups, do sit-ups, jumping jacks, jog in place, maybe buy yourself a jump rope. Start with basic exercises that are easy to do in your room. You can then jump in the shower, do by yourself. There's no big process. You don't have to change clothes and go to the gym and get your water bottle. You don't have to do any of that stuff. You can do it at home, maybe in your bedroom, in your living room, wherever you can. Sometimes people can't because they live in apartment buildings and you can't jump around. I get that. Maybe go for a jog. There's a few different things you can do. And the reason why I suggest the home workout, just to start, is it's more a matter of getting your mind in shape before your body to get used to this process, getting used to the process of exercising, normalizing the idea of exercising. A lot of times, like for example, starting this new year, a lot of people set a goal. I want to start working out. I want to lose 15 pounds. I want to lose 30 pounds. I want to, you know, save 15% by switching to Geico, whatever it may be. But they don't really have a plan in place, and they don't start with small steps. One of the quotes I always say to you guys is everything is small steps. Every single step can be broken down into smaller steps. And it's a matter of taking each micro step and moving a little bit closer towards your goal. You see the top of the staircase, but you're at the bottom right now. But you know that each step will lead you to the top of the staircase. And you're not going to jump up and get there in one leap. No, that's silly, you know? But you have to incrementally take each step until you get to the top. Sometimes you can take two steps. Sometimes you fall back and you know, you got to take another step. But you see that there's a path in place. So by starting these simple home workouts, push-ups, jumping jacks, sit-ups, crunches, whatever it may be, your mind will start to say, okay, I'm used to the idea of working out. I'm used to it now. I'm used to doing some kind of physical exercise. And then it may be easier for you to say, you know what? I'm going to, the same amount of time, I'm just going to do it now in the gym. So you may be able to get over that idea of I need a partner in the gym and I can start doing it myself because your mind is already used to exercising. So try that out, try out that technique. If you need more motivation in terms of working out, you can always turn to my brother. He's hardcore into working out now. He's developing himself. Look him up on Twitter, message him, just shoot him a tweet, at justneph, J-U-S-T-N-E-P-H, at justneph. His whole thing is the boom time movement. He talks about working out. You know, he always asks, what's your boom time? You know, what's the goal you want to accomplish? What's this big thing you want to hit? So if you want advice and tips and motivation to work out, look at justneph. I'll link his Twitter in the description as well, so you guys can reach out to him if working out is part of your New Year's resolution goals too. So let me talk a minute, just for a second here, about New Year's and about this idea of starting a new year. I recently put up a video called The Secret to New Year's Resolutions. If you haven't checked it out, definitely go check that one out. What I talk about in that video is this idea of how our New Year's resolutions tend to center around a numeric goal, like I want to lose 15 pounds, I want to make 30 friends, I want to be boyfriend and girlfriend with my crush, versus focusing on a value tied to it. So a value for working out instead of I want to lose 15 pounds is I want to feel healthy. I want to feel like I can breathe better. I want to feel like I can be physical and not be tired. Or making friends could be I want to make others feel comfortable. I want to make others feel relaxed around me. I want to make others feel like I'm approachable. It's these values that are underlying these kind of goals that kind of really set the foundation for things. So I think when it comes to moving into this new year, when we talk about getting ready for the new year and kind of building your best self, really look at the values of what you want to accomplish. So for example, if you like a girl and you always tell yourself, next year, I promise I'm going to ask her out. I'm not going to be scared to do it. I'm going to do it. Stop first and ask yourself, why do you want to ask her out? What is it about her that you like? And once you talk to her, let's say you do start dating, what do you hope to gain from that relationship? You know, do you want just the experience? Do you just think she's physically attractive and you maybe want to kiss her or something like that, make out with her, whatever it may be? Really understand the value as to what you want to do. First, understand that and then approach your goals, then approach what you want to accomplish. So that's kind of what I want to put out there. And just share with you guys just the main goal of this idea of getting ready for New Year's. I really love the questions you guys are asking, and I want to keep going. Let's keep moving forward. Let's keep knocking them out of the ballpark. If you guys do want to ask me questions one-on-one and I don't get to your questions now, you can always shoot me an email at thejoshspeaks@gmail.com. You can tweet at me at thejoshspeaks, Facebook message, Instagram, use ask.fm. Go to thejoshspeaks.com, click the ask a question section, and just choose the platform you want to message me on there. And I will jump in and answer your question as soon as I can, as early as I can, because I get a lot of questions. I try to get through as many as I can. So, okay, Minecraft asks a cool question. So what made me want to join YouTube? That's a cool question. If you guys are interested in learning more about me, I've done so far 2 Q&A videos where I answered just direct questions about me. Do I have a girlfriend? What's my religion? I think one of them was, why did I start YouTube? But I'll kind of answer that here too. So if you want to know more about just me as a person, search my channel, type in 10 facts about me that will blow your mind, or just type in Q&A and the 2 videos will pop up. You can learn directly more about me. Do that after the hangout here. What made me want to join YouTube? So I think what got me started here on YouTube originally, I'll cut out like my friends recording and wrestling in a park and recording videos. Me and my friends originally started doing comedy skits here on YouTube, and just for fun, stupid things that we would record, put on YouTube, you know, comedy stuff me and my friends did. And I started to say, okay, you know, there's a lot of things I like to talk about, a lot of topics in my head that I want to share. At the time, I was also doing like freelance video projects and trying to record for people. I ended up doing a project and I got there too late, and the guy told me, you're here too late, we're not going to record with you. So I was stuck in the city, Manhattan, with all my camera equipment. It was like 8 a.m. and I said, you know what? I want to set up my camera and I want to just talk about, share my opinions. I want to speak about something that I'm interested in. So I did. I talked about showing up early and planning ahead and being there early, because that's what happened to me the other day. Showed up late, I didn't plan ahead, whatever it was. So I talked about that. And then as time went on, I said, you know what? I want to also talk about things that I'm reading about and learning about. So originally I was doing book reviews. I was sharing my opinions on philosophy and religion and culture and dating and everything I was learning at the time. And as the channel started to grow, I started to see a certain theme developing where it's like, I feel all this learning I'm doing for myself is helping me become a better version of myself. And that's what I want to help people do too. I want to help people kind of develop their best self. And the channel kind of grew into that movement. And over the years, I've kind of really started to define more and more what I want to do, how I want to do it with you guys, and how I really want to help you guys grow and be better people. So that's kind of the, hit this microphone again. It's kind of the gist of it. If you want to know the bigger story, maybe more details, more facts about it, I'll definitely go into details. I could do that in another video, separate video just for that if you guys are interested. So leave it in the comments and let me know. But that's kind of what made me want to start doing YouTube. Blaster, thank you so much for joining, man. I know you need to go to sleep. It's kind of late. Thank you guys too. Yeah, see David, it's 2 p.m. Oh, David, it's afternoon there for him. So he's cool. He's good. But yeah, you know, like Blaster, thanks for joining. So there's a few more older questions here that I'm skipping over. So Brandon asked this. Let's see. Brandon Garcia says, "Hey Josh, just wanted to give a little advice that I believe will help everyone. This is perfect. Don't see a girl and go up to her and ask her out before getting to know her. My point is to talk to a girl and get to know her before you ask someone out. I did this out especially." I think there's maybe more to the question here, but yeah, I think he's on the money there. Definitely. The idea is don't just go up to her and ask her out. You know, like imagine if someone came up to you in a store. Imagine you're in a supermarket, right? And someone came up to you and said, "Hi, see this candy bar? Do you want to buy this candy bar?" And you're like, "I've never heard of this candy bar before." And they're like, "Well, do you want to buy it or not?" You'd feel like pressured. And most probably you're going to say no off the bat. You're going to go, "Oh, no, thanks." Out of fear because you don't know anything about it. But if someone came to you and said, "Hey, watch this quick YouTube video on this candy bar and this is what it tastes like," and gave you a sample and they let you try it out, let you know a little bit more about it, over time you may say, "You know what, I'm interested in a candy bar, I wanna try it, I'll buy it." Everything takes time to develop. So by directly just asking someone out, you're not giving the ample amount of time to develop what you guys may potentially have. So a lot of times guys are nervous, too scared to talk to the crush. They secretly keep it, you know, hidden to themselves. And then they just blurt out their feelings and they just kind of say, "I like you. I want to go out with you." There isn't development there. They haven't taken the time to get to know the person, to talk with them, to laugh with them, to communicate, to connect. It's in that process that you really can get closer and closer to asking someone out successfully. So Brandon, thank you so much for the advice. I really appreciate it. So Aiden said, "Thanks for the answer. My friend actually suggested I ask him to invite her, but I was a bit nervous being a senior and all having my eye on a freshman girl. Anyway, I'm heading out now." So Aiden, I know what you're saying. So one thing Aiden had brought up to me in the past is this idea, and I think a lot of us have this question too. What is the right, is it weird if a senior guy in high school talks to a freshman girl? What's the difference in age? Is that weird or anything like that? Here's my opinion. So I think when it comes to maybe a senior in high school talking to a freshman girl, I think that it's okay, you know, like if you're in the same kind of grade bracket, so I would say high school is a grade bracket, middle school is a grade bracket, college is a grade bracket. If you're in the same kind of bracket, I think it's okay to be talking to anyone within the mix because there's someone you see on a daily basis, you're both in the same school, I feel like it's close enough. Some people may say, "You're a senior, man. Oh, she's a freshman." I get that. But I would say screw the haters, you know? Like if you're in the same bracket, then that's okay. I think it's fine. But Aiden, thanks for popping in again, man. I can't wait to launch this project with you. So I'm going to talk to you more about them. I'm going to shoot you an email and we'll talk about it. So Alex too also asked that question, is it wrong to be a junior interested in a freshman girl? I don't think it is. I think if you're both within the same, you're both in high school, it's perfectly fine and perfectly normal to like someone. You're both around the same age, you know, you're not that far off. So I don't think that you should be too worried about that. Let's see what else we got here. Okay, so Zero asked, and then I'm going to get to William Randall after. So Zara asked, Josh, this is another serious thing I want to tell you. I used to date a girl in 2013, and the memory of her cheating on me still haunts me, hurting my heart and making me unhappy to this day. I try to keep myself occupied, but too many things remind me of her. I trust her. Remind him of the trust. I gave her all I could, and it wasn't sufficient for her. It breaks me inside. Still, how can I move on when and everything around me brings the painful memories back? Okay, so this idea of still longing for your crush or still longing for your ex-girlfriend or ex-boyfriend, still feeling like, I can't let them go. I still think about them every single day. It's tough. It's hard to move on. It's a very hard thing to do for some people. And there's nothing wrong with still having feelings for someone that you once liked. It's a perfectly normal thing. It's perfectly acceptable. Now, as I said in the beginning of this whole hangout, what matters not is how you feel, like how you feel is going to happen. What matters is how you choose to move forward with it and how you choose to handle your feelings. So if you like someone that you used to like, it's someone that's your ex, and you can't get over them, one of the important things to do is to, I think first off, come to terms with it. Don't try to lie to yourself. Don't say, I need to get rid of them. I need to forget about them. Don't try to convince yourself that you can do it if you don't feel you can. First, tell yourself, this is how I feel. I like them. Okay, I'll work with that. The next thing you should do is you have to start interacting with more people. You have to start talking to new girls or new guys. You have to start making new friends. You have to start changing your environment around. A lot of times the reason why you stay focusing on your ex is because your environment doesn't change. You know, you may notice this, and maybe I'm making a grand claim here, but it seems like a lot of girls, whenever they break up with the boyfriend, they end up changing their hair, coloring their hair, doing something different, changing their physical appearance because they feel it's reinventing themselves. That's something we can all do. You know, if you break up with an ex, do something to reinvent yourself. Pick up a new hobby. If you're going out with someone and you break up, say, you know what? I'm going to start writing. I'm going to start playing music. I'm going to start doing sports. I'm going to start traveling. I'm going to start, you know, doing a bunch of different things. You know, try something new and meet new people along the way, because as you meet more people, as you kind of expand your horizon, you're going to end up finding more people that you enjoy spending your time with. And the more you spend your day enjoying life, the less you're going to be worrying about what you missed out on or what you don't have. Now, you may get those feelings every once in a while that's going to pop in your mind and think, man, I miss what that was like. I remember that. And that's normal. That's what I'm saying. That's the normal feeling. But what's important is that you are moving forward and you are making new friendships and you are trying out new hobbies and you are allowing yourself to like other people as you go along. So, and then I wanted to jump into William's question here, because he asked it before and he says it's urgent. I kept missing it. So William Randall says, okay, Josh, I have a question for you. So I like this girl, and her friend said, will you tell me who you like? Now, I'm a very trustworthy person. After that person who I like quieted the person who was going to tell me, the next day she sat next to one of my friends who also likes. The next day she said that the person that she sat next to with her friends was her friend. Okay, I'm kind of confused. I think what he's saying is this, that someone asked him, hey, can you tell me who you like? And he told them. And then he saw that girl probably hanging out with his crush. There's always this fear. And I think this happens a lot in middle school and high school, college, even elementary school. It happens everywhere where it's like the friends will come up to you and go, hey, who do you like? Or this person likes you. And the friends, let me tell you something about friends. They always love to jump in and be a part of it and like play with the drama and do that kind of stuff. Friends love being part of the hype. And I think that's something that normally you're just going to have to expect. So if one of their friends comes up to you is like, hey, do you like anyone? Who do you like? Why do you like them? All these kinds of things. The best thing to do is to not feed into the gossip machine and to be direct. So if the friend is asking, hey, do you like my friend? You can say, maybe, we'll see. I want to get to know her better. And that's the safest answer you can give. Maybe, we'll see. I want to get to know them better. Because if they go reporting back, that person will say, do they like me? And that gives you all the more reason to go talk to your crush. So I think in William's case, that kind of happened. The best thing I think if you guys are in that situation is let them know, maybe I need to get to know them better. It's a safe answer. It's a secure answer. And it allows you to decide, I want to go talk to them now one-on-one rather than having to do it through their friend. So I would say try that out. Okay, so let's check out some more of these questions. I know I skipped over a few of them. But Future Gaming asked this one. I think this is a good question. So let's jump in. So Josh, I have a stepbrother and a stepsister, and the sister is very annoying and very sensitive. How can I live through it? Thanks for the previous answer. It helped. I'm glad it helped out, Future. So let's talk about this. Let's talk about stepbrothers, stepsisters, or just family in general sometimes. That can be very annoying, very sensitive, very loud, very angry. You know, sometimes we don't always get to choose who our family is or the people that we kind of have to be around with that we call family. We don't always get to choose who they are. And we don't always know sometimes how they're going to respond or react. Everyone has a different personality. Some people are more sensitive. Some people are more annoying. It happens. And the big question is, well, how do I deal with it? This is what I have to be around. How the hell do I deal with it? I think the important thing is to recognize sometimes that a person's behavior usually stems from their upbringing and what they've learned and how they've lived life and how they've interacted with others. So if a person ends up being a little annoying, maybe it's because they haven't had someone in their life to balance them out, to help them, to help them recognize, hey, maybe I shouldn't talk about those things or talk about them so much or talk about them so intensely. Maybe they haven't had that person to help balance them. Or if someone's very sensitive, it could be because maybe when they were growing up, someone said something that hurt their feelings, it made them feel insecure. There's a million reasons. I think this is so very important, no matter who the person is, no matter if it's the most wicked person in the world or the nicest person in the world, the key link between those two is that they're both people. And everyone is representative of what they've learned and experienced throughout life. So don't ever sell anyone short. Doesn't mean you have to be forgiving and tolerant of every behavior and every action, but don't write them off as that's an annoying person, that's a bad person, that's an ugly person, that's an evil person. No one is one characteristic. We are many things all wrapped in one bundle. So be aware and understanding of that. So if you are around people that you do find annoying and do find sensitive or do things that bother you, try to focus on yourself, try to focus on developing an inner sense of peace. That may mean when you're around someone that's bothering you a lot, try to close your eyes, try focusing on your breathing, try different techniques that allow you to kind of escape sometimes the craziness and to center yourself again. We talked about centering earlier in another question. Try to allow yourself to be centered. Don't allow any kind of negativity to infiltrate your system. Allow it to bounce off so that you can feel more comfortable and relaxed and not always so tied down by like the negativity that may be around you. So, you know, you can't always avoid it. Sometimes you kind of deal with it, your family. But there are ways to kind of to handle it and stuff. I did a video on dealing with family members. I'm going to put that in the description as well. Future Gaming, I definitely think you should check it out. So, okay. So quick question here. Maple Bell asks, advice for small YouTubers. So I'll make this quick. So one thing I think small YouTubers can focus on is working with their small audience to kind of develop more content, to use that small audience initially to help them grow. So think of it like this. Let's say you're a musician, right? And you make music and you think it's great, but no one comes to your shows. But you have a few friends that may like your stuff. Your friends, those initial small group of friends, will be your key to growth. You know, like that's the word of mouth that you need. So if you're a small YouTube channel and you have a very small audience, what I would focus on is interacting with your viewers and your people who leave comments directly. Be very there in the comments with them and say, hey, listen, I know you like my videos. Can you help by sharing it? Can you help by, you know, like connecting me with other YouTubers? Are there anyone else that you think I should collab with? Use the audience as a way to kind of really build that initial foundation of a real team. You know, small YouTube channels, it's like the viewers function like a team. You know, when you have huge YouTube channels, it's so easy to be disconnected from, because there's so many people that you can't connect with them. When you're small, it's easy to really get down on the ground and say, hey, listen, guys, work with me here. Let me know what you want to see. What videos should I put out? Who should I work with? Who should I collab with? So I would say that would be the best thing. Work with your audience, really get on their level, talk to them, and they'll want to show support and help you and share your videos and do things like that. Let's look at a few more here. A few more questions. We got a bunch coming in. More viewers are coming in. It's almost at the 2 hour mark. Maybe I'll go a little bit over and answer a few more. I'm so happy and excited you guys are here. I mean, we're going to go into 2016 in hours, you know, like literally less than a full day's worth of time now at this, actually it was only 11 o'clock here. It's 25 hours for me, but anyway, we're going to enter the 2016. It's a brand new year, and this is the chance to debut a brand new you. I made a playlist a while back, including all my different New Year's videos and my points on New Year's and everything. If you want to check it out on my channel, I'll link the playlist down below. I'm going to put a lot of links down there. And also, if you guys want to see what my answers are to specific questions, I'm going to put the timestamps down in the description as well. So you don't have to watch through the whole thing. You can kind of jump around to the questions that you want and get an idea of, you know, what my answer was on that specific thing. So I'm going to put that in there as well. So let's check out Edgar's. Edgar Aranda says, hey, Josh, I'm a junior and I like a freshman girl, but she goes to a different school. And my friends would make fun of me if I dated a freshman, What should I do? Usually hang out with her and we both enjoy it. Please help. Okay, so Edgar, I made a video a while back called how to date someone from a different school, I think it was called. I'm really bad at remembering my own video titles. How to date someone from a different school. And in it, I talk about measuring, okay, does it make sense to try to date someone from another school? Am I going to be able to see them? Will we be able to make it work? Is it realistic? So I talk about this idea of whether or not it's realistic. For you, it sounds like you guys get along. You are able to see each other. It is realistic, and I definitely think you should go for it. Your friends may make fun of you. This question keeps popping up. I'm a junior. I like a freshman. I'm a senior. I like a freshman. Question keeps popping up, and people think, oh, I'm going to make fun of you for it. It doesn't even matter. We're talking about 2 years. You know, let's say you're a junior, 16, 17, and a freshman is 14, 15. We're talking about a few years difference here. It doesn't make that big of a deal. You both are in high school. You're both in your high school level. It's perfectly okay. There's nothing wrong with it. So I think it is possible. I think you should go for it. You guys seem like you get along. You both enjoy it. You're both willing to try to make it work. And that's really what matters when it comes down. If you're both willing to put in the effort, go for it, man. Don't worry so much about what your friends say. Sorry if I'm yawning a lot. It's not because I'm tired. It's because I think I'm speaking so much. I got to drink more water. That's probably why I'm yawning so much. Matthew, don't worry. Ask as many questions as you can. I'm trying to jump in and answer them. There's a lot of people asking, and I hope Bruce, Happy New Year's Eve to you too, man. I'm going to try to get as much as I can here. Okay, so this looks like a good one too. Justin Doan says, the girl I like is in three of my classes and at my lunch table with me. But most of the time, I only have 1 or 2 minutes to talk, and she's always talking to someone anyways. How can I engage her and have a good conversation in such a short time? So I made a video a long time ago called How to Ask a Girl Out in Front of Her Friends. I feel like I want to revisit the topic and maybe even break it down into smaller chunks. Because there's so many different situations where she's with her friends, after class, during lunch, after school, you know, you're in a group project with her, there's other people involved. There's a lot of different situations where people get involved. So in this case, the girl's in three of his classes and at his lunch table, but there's only a few minutes for him to talk to her. So maybe she's interacting and the only times he can talk to her maybe is when she's leaving the room or before class begins, or, you know, like when she's waiting for her friends to show up for lunch or after lunch or something like that. So how do you kind of have this quick conversation in this short amount of time? Well, here's what I think. I think where it starts is using that those 2 minutes initially. Using those 2 minutes initially to kind of just ask a question to get something going. So for example, if you see her walking out of class, you can walk up to her and say, hey, I need to ask you a question very quickly. I gotta head to class. But what do you think about blah, blah, blah? Or like I said earlier, me and my friends want to go to the movies. What movie do you think we should check out? Quick answer, go. You know, something like that that's very simple, very easy for her to jump into. And when she shares her opinion, you can easily say, you know, you're pretty cool. I'm gonna remember that. And then from there, you can talk to her regularly, say hi to her now. Once you've already established some kind of basis where you guys at least have talked once in a while, it's easier then to jump in later and to say hi just whenever you want to. And then from there, you can continue and make that 1 minute into a 2 minute, that 2 minute into a 5 minute, or maybe that 5 minute turns into, hey, let's spend lunch together. Hey, let's meet up after school. Hey, let me hang out with you and your friends. You know, it really is small steps. Everything is small steps. It's a matter of building yourself up as you go along. So I hope that answers the question, Justin. So let's take a look at the Google Plus page and see what's going on over there. Okay, so okay, here we go. So John Cena Gaming says, okay, so another question. I'm in middle school and I have dreams of to go to MIT. How would I be able to get there? Also, how did you deal with college as a teenager? Okay, so I'll share a little of my experience when I was a high schooler and preparing for college and the craziness. Okay, Matthew, I'm gonna get to your question right after this. Your battery's at 10%. I'm gonna get to your question. I'm gonna select it so that it's listed. But first, let's talk about preparing for college. For me, when I was in high school, I didn't know what college I wanted to get into. I think it's awesome that you want to go to MIT, so that's a very ambitious goal. I think what's going to be required of you is to work hard and to really stay focused and to tell yourself, what do I need to do to get into MIT? I need to really excel in my schoolwork. I need to really be able to learn things quickly. I need to really appreciate having teachers that teach me. You know, a big part of it is being appreciative of the ability to learn. You know, like, cool, you know what? This teacher's going to spend this time talking to me in class. I'm going to bust my ass and really learn. For me, when I was in high school, I had no clue what college I wanted to go to. My parents suggested a college, and I said, okay, I'll go there. And it wasn't until years into college that I really started to determine what I wanted to do with myself. I wanted to go into business and marketing and learn digital arts and learn Photoshop and video and learn the communication side of things and how to create things that really make people feel inspired in some way. So I think sometimes you know what you want to do, sometimes you don't. But if you have a goal of going to a specific college, I would ask yourself, same thing I said before, why is that college important to you? Is it important just because you've heard of it? Is it important because you know that it has something of value that it can bring to you later in life? Is it going to help you change the world? That's an important question to ask too. So Matthew, I want to quickly get to yours. Which questions was his? I'm going to quickly look through. So Matthew said, okay, here. I think this is the one he wanted. How do I deal with jealousy? My crush and I are in a group chat on Hangouts, and there is this guy who flirts with her and says how he would give his heart to her, but he is in another country. So jealousy. I did a video on jealousy too, how to deal with jealousy in a relationship. I'll link that one in the description as well. These are all important videos, guys. You guys got to check them out. So when it comes to dealing with jealousy, I think it comes down to recognizing that sometimes people talk a lot of game. It's like this guy is in another country and he's talking to her. Like, he's saying whatever he's saying because he knows he can get away with it. I think that's a big part of it too. A lot of times guys and girls will say things because they know I can say this and it will make this person believe anything I say. So I would take what he says with a grain of salt. What matters more is not so much what he's doing. What matters more is what you're doing. So if you like this girl, are you flirting with her? Are you talking to her? Are you making the attempt to make her feel like, hey, this guy likes me, I like him too? If you're just casually watching this other guy do it, then you're not stepping up to the plate. It has nothing to do with him. has everything to do with what you feel you're capable of. So use your ability to move forward. Don't feel hindered by someone else. Don't let some other guy kind of interfere. Step up to the plate. Don't talk about it. Be about it. Talk to this girl. So Matthew, I hope that this is a good answer for your question. I know your laptop's dying. Thank you so much for your laptop. If you got to tune out, then thanks for being a part of this, man. So let's look at some more questions here. So Bruce has more advice here. Bruce says, to Blaster, he's responding, I don't think all girls have to be a gamer to date them. If you want a gamer girlfriend, try to introduce it to her after you date her. Don't make it a criteria for girlfriend material. Absolutely on the money, Bruce. You totally nailed it. You shouldn't determine, oh, I can only go out with someone who plays video games. It may be something that you may introduce your girlfriend to once you start dating, and she may end up liking it. You may be able to share that with her. So that's something you definitely you can work towards. Bruce, thank you for jumping in and offering your two cents there too. So here, Aiden, he does track and everything, and he runs a lot. So he offered some good advice for workouts. Basic workouts should we do? Another good workout would be one of these workout programs, T25 or P90X3. They don't take very long. They're great for beginners and they're very effective. If you can't get those, go for a run a few days a week. Can't hurt. But so exactly. So if you feel introverted and you feel like you want to start working out and it's a little tough and challenging, start with basic things at home that you can do by yourself. You don't need to always have a gym. Sometimes people need to work up to gyms. So Aiden gives great advice. T25 or P90X3 are basic things you can do. So those are basic things Aiden gives a sound, very sound advice there. Okay, so Justin has another question that's very serious. So let's go through this one. So we're going to have to put my dog down after New Year's. How do I deal with this? Because it's the first pet I'm going to lose. So first off, Justin, I want to say I feel really bad and I'm sorry to hear that. I'm really sorry that is the case. Pets are family members at the end of the day. You know, these are animals that want to live just as much as you and I do. They love, they feel pain, they suffer, but they also love to smile and have fun and run around, just like every one of us, you know. So pets are part of our family. There's no denying that. And it's sad when, you know, you have to put an animal down, maybe because it's too old or it's sick or any of the number of reasons. And it's never easy to deal with, and it's never easy to kind of encounter. And I think an important thing to know is that if you're surrounded by people who love the animal just as much as you do, know that that animal's going to, you know, rest in peace knowing that it was loved. It's going to be treated nicely by the people around it that love it. And if you ever feel like you need to talk to someone, you can always talk to your family about how you feel and how this is making you feel. It's okay to say to your parents or your mother, father, sister, brother, anyone, I'm angry and this bothers me. It's okay to say those things because all you're doing is expressing yourself. And I think that's a positive thing to do, to talk about how you're feeling. Is a very positive thing to do. So if you are feeling hurt, if you are feeling sad about this, and you feel like you're losing a member of your family, it's okay to talk about it. You can talk to anyone that you feel is open to listening. And I think people who also love the animal too will definitely be open to listening. So I'm sorry to hear that, Justin. I hope everything, you know, can move on as things go on. So Neon jumped in. Neon offered some advice for David. He said, do 4 sets of 5 when you start working out. After some time, when 4 sets starts to become easy for you, add another set. Keep adding one more as time goes on. It will put much less strain in your body, but can still give you good results. So for those of you who don't know, a set is a rep is repetitions. So if I'm doing 10 bench presses, that's 10 repetitions. If I do 10 and then stop, and then later I do 10 again, each block of 10 is a set. Sorry, I keep hitting the microphone. Each block of 10 is a set. So, you know, you do 3 sets of 10, it's 30 altogether. So keep adding on another set once you feel it becomes too easy doing what you're already doing. So Neon Wave says, this world is made of love and peace. All right, dude, I'll see you around. He's heading out. Yeah, it's already 11, but I want to answer. So Neon has suggested how to be or stay motivated. That's a good topic. Are you going to post the whole thing on YouTube? I like Iguana's ask. Yes, the Google Hangouts are always live after the event on my YouTube channel. I'm going to hopefully within the next hour try to go through and do the timestamps and everything to put all the links in there so that you guys have all the resources. It's always going to be in the description of the video. If you are going to jump back in and kind of watch parts that you missed, make sure to hit the like button. And you know, share this. And if you do have specific questions you want to ask me, you can always do it. Like I said, go to the joshspeaks.com, and ask a question, and I'll be there to, you know, choose the platform that you want to ask me on, and I'll be there to answer it. So happy New Year's to you too, David, and to everyone else. So this is another question here. Tater Terminator. I love the name. It's just, it's just a cool name. It says, I'm black and in a white school. There's a white girl who I have a crush on and she doesn't want to talk to me. I feel left out because I have no friends. Please help. So this issue, I think, stems a lot deeper than a lot of the stuff we talk about. I think when we talk a lot about these dating things, they're very surface level things. It's like, I like someone and I don't know what to do. It's not that it's not important, but it's more surface level. Tater Terminator, it sounds like what you may be experiencing is a lot deeper, and that is rooted in maybe things like racism, rooted in bigotry and hatred and a lack of understanding and awareness of others. And maybe that's something that you experience in your school. One thing I would definitely recommend for you to do is to check out Cheskele, I think is her name. She does a lot of videos on these kind of topics of dealing with situations where there's this kind of like racial distinction where it's like, oh, I don't want to talk to you because you're this, or I don't like you because you're that, or feeling left out in different communities and environments. Cheskele, I think, I don't know how to spell that, but I'll link it in the description as well. You can find her on YouTube. I think in your case, you're not alone. There's a lot of people who often feel like that too, where they feel left out because of their skin color or race or religion or whatever it may be. And I think what's important is to try to find other people in different communities, whether it's online communities, whether it's people in other schools, whoever you can, try to do some research and try to find people that have dealt with these situations before on a bigger level. So it's like racial issues and things like that are not so much things that I talk about on this channel, but they are huge issues. And there are a lot of channels on YouTube dedicated to really tackling these topics. The one thing I would say is that no one deserves to have prejudice held against them for their race. And if you do like a girl and she doesn't like you for any kind of racial reasons, then I know how much that can suck, and it's not nice and it's not good, and it's a backwards way of looking at things. But I would say to try to be persistent in talking to her. It's possible that, you know, just talking to her, getting to know her might make her see beyond any kind of things that she was taught or any kind of craziness that she's been raised to believe. But if you do see that there is that wall, then I would say she may just not be the type of girl that you want to be with, because if she's not thinking clearly and she's not open to accepting people genuinely for who they are, then that's not the kind of person you want to be around. So Skulix Gaming says, I have the same problem as Tater Terminator. I'm Jewish and nobody likes me. That's also another problem too. I think that people can be very prejudiced about other people of other races, people of other religions, sexual identities, genders. And I think hopefully the one thing I want people to always take away from this is that you're special just the way you are. There's no one in this world like you, and there never will be. You are one of a kind in every way, and we are all connected no matter what we're misled to believe. We all share this earth. We all have the desire to live and to be, and I think it's important to recognize that. So if you do feel discriminated against in any way, it's important to try to reach out to people in your community and to look online to find people who have also experienced the same kind of hate or prejudice or anything like that, and to see how they've dealt with it. It's in learning through others' experiences that you can learn to balance and understand your own. Okay, so I'm gonna answer just maybe a few more questions here. And then I'm gonna try to wrap it up so I can get to the other parts of this, but let's answer a question from the Google Plus page itself. Let's see, okay, so a bunch have come in. Okay, so let's scroll down a little bit. Give me 1 second here, and okay. So this is something. So let's try to answer this one here. So B Lissy says, "Hey there. There is someone who I don't particularly get along with and haven't for about 2 years now. I find myself getting closer and closer to getting physical. In fact, it already has. I try to relax, but sometimes this guy is too much. I've reached out to my parents and to my school and to him. I'm just afraid that he would push me to the point where I make a mistake. I happen to be bigger than him, making it all the more difficult. Thoughts?" So bullies come in all shapes and sizes. They can be smaller than us. They could be a girl bully to a guy. They could be a guy bully to a girl. You know, there's no limit on jerks, I think, and what they're capable of looking like. So the question is, you know, not so much what they're dealing with and what they're doing, how they're being a bully. It's more, how do you learn to deal with that? How do you cope with people interfering and bothering you and causing you problems? And how do you contain yourself so that you don't get crazy and you don't act out of line? Because you don't want to be that person who leads things to physical violence. And that's just not who you are. You know, you're capable, just like we're all capable of being pushed there, but that's not what you want to do. And I think you're one step ahead of the game because you already know that that's not something that you want to do. I think the next step is to, as hard as it may be and as cheesy as the advice may sound, to try to talk to them. So, and I don't mean talk to them and say something like, "Hey, it's not cool when you do this," you know, not like that. You can always just pull them aside and be like, "Dude, what's going on? What's the problem, man? What's up with you?" Do it in private. Don't do it. Keep hitting the microphone. Do it in private. Don't do it in front of people. And there's a chance they may open up to you. Now, if they're just like, "Oh, I fucking like you. I don't like you." Then if that's the case, then you just tell them, "Look, dude, just, you know, stay out of my way, man. Leave me alone. I don't have any problems with you. I don't want to have any problems with you. Just go about your business," and try to really just push them to do their own thing. If they keep bothering you and keep bothering you and you try talking to a parent or a teacher or anyone, it won't leave you alone. I mean, I never want to suggest threatening someone or anything like that, but you may have to intimidate them, not in a violent way, but intimidate them as in, listen, your actions are going to affect you on a bigger level than you think. And that might mean telling them something like, "Hey, listen, dude, if you keep bothering me, we're going to have to go to the principal and you're going to get in a lot of trouble for this." That's the intimidation I'm talking about. Let them see that, "Hey, if I keep acting this way, then it's going to cause bigger problems." That's probably the best thing you could do. And I would say focus on breathing, focus on pulling yourself out of a situation, focusing on centering yourself so that these things don't overflow your mind and don't wipe you out and cause you to do something you regret. So, all right, let's answer two more questions here. Okay, so Skulik says, "Can I have some advice on making friends? I have a lot of trouble making friends because of my race, religion, and tendency to hurt people." So I feel like if you guys want, this is definitely something I'll do a video on. I could definitely talk about how to ask a girl out when you're a different race, or how to make friends when you don't share the same religion or something like that. I definitely wanna do videos on that. I may bring on people who do specific channels dedicated to these kind of topics to kind of guest host it with me. But so my advice on making friends with people who are different from you, different race, different religion, is that what you ultimately want to try to appeal to is their human side. So think about it like this. We all find things funny, different things funny, right? So if we can overlap our humor, if we could find a common joke or a common thing to laugh at or a common thing we both enjoy, I feel like that could be the groundwork. So for example, let's say you're talking to someone who's of a different race or religion, but you like Marvel and they like Marvel. You mention something or Star Wars, you mention something Star Wars related, and they say, oh, cool, I like Star Wars too. That may be the initial groundwork you need to overlook these kind of race or religion things that are like, I don't like you because you're this. You know, try to find a common ground in trying to make those friends, and that's maybe how you can start to build it. Now, if they are prejudiced and they are all these different things, you gotta ask yourself, are those really the friends you want? Because I don't think they would be. Okay, so we got one more question here. To all the 55 viewers here, thank you guys so much for tuning in. If you still have more questions, like I said, go to thejoshspeaks.com, click the Ask a Question section and ask me your question there, or leave your comments in on the video, and I'm gonna jump in and answer as many as I can throughout the day, tomorrow, whatever it may be. Also, I want you guys to know that, like I said, I'm gonna be launching a new program in 2016, and that's gonna be this kind of group Google Hangout thing where a bunch of us are gonna get together, and we're gonna kind of share ideas and tackle specific questions like, what's a good opener to talk to a girl? Or how do you deal with rejection from your crush? Or what's the best way to stay focused studying for a test? We're gonna tackle each individual question as a group, share our opinions, our stories. It's gonna be a fun thing. We're gonna have our little Knights of the Round, and we're gonna record those and put that on YouTube so to share that info with you guys too. And also for 2016, one of the big things, so fear plays, I don't know if your question's serious. I hope it is. I hope it isn't, because that's horrible if it is. But if you are encountering a situation where anyone is causing any kind of physical harm to you, emotionally, sexually, or anything like that, definitely call the cops. Definitely let someone know, because that's a serious situation to be in. And, you know, there are times where that happens to people who are adopted. And if you are experiencing, if any one of you are experiencing any kind of situation where someone is emotionally, physically, or sexually abusing you, then definitely talk to a school guidance counselor. Don't be afraid to call the cops. It's very important that you take care of that issue. Don't feel bad and say, but it's my parent, it's okay. No, if they are doing that to you, then you need to talk to someone. But that's not the last question I want to end this on. I was going to say, so what I'm rolling out in 2016, I'm going to be developing online courses for you guys as well. The first one I'm going to create is a dating course, and it's going to take you from the A to the Z. It's going to be all about building the confidence to talk to your crush, to asking them out, to going on dates, to being boyfriend and girlfriend, dealing with rejection along the way, and even dealing with breakups if it may happen. So I'm going to put together this full expansive video course for you guys that's going to be available on my website at some point, but I'm going to develop that throughout the year. So I'm really looking forward to that. So one final question. This will be the question that's going to end the Google Hangout. And okay, so I'm looking through here. And I'm gonna find a good one here. So side question for the last one. So Skulix Gaming says, I'm not sure who my real parents are and they won't tell me. Please give me some advice on talking to parents about being adopted. That's a really good question. I don't think I have any kind of expertise in dealing with issues like that, but I know there are plenty of YouTubers who do. So Skulix Gaming, I'm definitely gonna reach out to you after this, and I will try to put you in contact with the person that hopefully can help you tackle that issue. But so let's find a question. Guys, 2016 is right around the corner. This is a new year. I just want to say this. Let's answer one more question and then I'll give my final go-to speech for you guys. So, okay, Ninja Kelly will end it. In the summer, I was super close to this guy and he became my best friend. He knew that I liked him, but didn't say anything because he was leaving to another country for a year. He came back for a week to visit, but feels like a stranger. What should I do? So in the summer, there was Ninja Kelly and this guy became super close. The guy knew that she liked him, but he was leaving for another country. When he came back to visit, they kind of lost that connection. So what should you do? I made a video a while back called How to Get the Girl That Got Away, but it can also easily be How to Get the Guy That Got Away. I'll link that in the description as well. And what I talk about in that video is kind of not jumping on the kind of the horse when it's there and saying, you know what, like I'm going to do this. I'm going to ask them out. I'm going to go for it, and missing the opportunity and feeling that sense of, I missed my chance. It really sucks. In a situation like this, sometimes, and I also did a video about summer camp and dating in summer camp where I talk about this idea that the summertime and what you do during the summer can be kind of difficult because it's such a short period of time. So it's easy to develop a very fast relationship. Like let's say you're going to summer camp for a week. You can easily fall in love with someone after a few days because it's like everything's sped up there. It sounds like this is a guy that maybe you got to know and you know, he was going away for a year, so you didn't really have the opportunity to build anything out. So when he came back, you know, all this time had passed where you guys kind of disconnected. You know, it happens sometimes when people go away for a while, people disconnect. So I think it's important to recognize the realistic possibility. You know, is this person someone I can have a long distance relationship with? Are we both willing to try it out? If not, then are they someone that maybe I'm better off just being friends with? This is something that you need to ask yourself here. It sounds like this guy may just be better off being your friend just because the idea of you dating someone who's moving away and was only visiting for a week may not be realistic. So I know it sucks and I know it's hard, but that's what I think maybe has to happen. So guys, thank you so much for all your questions. I tried to knock out as many as I could in 2 hours. What I want to say is this. 2016 is upon us. We are on the eve of 2016. We're about to enter a new year. And what I think is so important is to approach this new year with a mindset where you are willing to be your best self. I mention these words a lot. And what I mean by that is learning to take your best attributes and boosting them just a little bit more. Learning to take the things you're weak at and saying, hey, how can I improve this? How can I learn? How can I test out my abilities? How can I try new things? That really is the culmination of being your best self. And I think the start of a new year, the beginning of the calendar month, January, it gives us this opportunity to kind of like reboot and refresh and to start over. So one thing you need to ask yourself is this. Are you ready to begin this new year? Are you ready to begin your transition? Are you ready to become your best self? I want to help you along the way as much as I can. And I'm going to do everything I can this year to help you build your confidence, become more mindful, and practice compassion towards other people. This next year is going to be a challenge for both you and me. It's going to be a challenge for you because you are going to be trying things you've never done before. You're going to be putting yourself in situations that may make you feel weird and awkward, but damn it, you are going to succeed in learning. You're going to succeed in understanding what it's like to get over your fears. You're going to succeed in understanding what it's like to deal with rejection. And most importantly, you're going to succeed in understanding what it truly means to be confident. Now, it's going to be a challenge for me because my goal is to work towards doing everything that I'm doing as the focus in my life. I really want to build out the Josh Speaks to be what I'm doing with my life. And that means I got to work extra hard. I need your guys' help in doing that too. I'll need you guys to help share my videos, to spread the word, to ask me questions, to participate, to thumbs it up, to interact in every way that you can. Because The more we reach, the more we teach. And the purpose of this channel is to help everyone grow. So I want to thank each and every single one of you for being part of this Google Hangout. Thank every single one of you for leaving comments and answering other people, for asking questions tonight, and to just first and foremost, to being open-minded to learning and to changing, because that's what's going to be required of us in this new year. So if you're getting ready for 2016 like I am, be prepared for everything that's going to come your way. Don't talk about it, be about it. Thank you guys so much for being a part of this. I really appreciate you joining in the Google Hangout. I'll make sure to add all the stuff in the description, the links, the timestamps, all the information I mentioned here. So I will catch you guys another time. And as always, guys, love and peace. I'll see you later.